happy Monday, everybody.
Oh, I don't know about that.
Why not?
Well, it's just getting up on Monday. Everyone's got a case of it.
Everybody's got a case of it. The Mondays, you mean.
Yes, I do.
Welcome to Jim Norton and Sam Roberts. Oh, what a day, what a day it's going to be.
Well, I don't know. We'll see.
Well, you're not
freezing.
It really is.
We're going to be 50-mile-an-hour wind gusts today.
Is there?
I don't like the way your arms are already folded and cold.
Because I was so uncomfortable walking here from the train.
Why?
It was cold.
By the way, people who always ask about my window updates, still a bit breezy.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
It was very windy this weekend.
It was going good. The windows were going good. But then it was kind of cold in the apartment yesterday, and I put my hand in front of one of the windows.
Yeah?
Most of them are better, but there's one of them that's still, it's like this.
Was there a breeze escaping through?
Coming through, like, fucking, I had the heat on really high, and it was literally like 30-degree air blowing on my hand. I'm like, oh, that would explain why I'm cold in my underwear.
Well, what floor do you live on?
20th.
So usually as you get higher, the weather gets... Oh, that's
much
not
windier.
So good for
yeah,
you.
Yeah, no,
then.
It's not. Especially since there's nothing right in front of me.
Yeah.
The air is just coming. Like, there's no... if you're in between buildings, it's not as bad because the fucking air will get blocked. But I have a decent view, so... Oof.
Not
good.
It
was very chilly yesterday.
Yeah, you sacrificed some nice, warm, toasty heat for your view.
Yeah, I'm going to get that fixed, though.
When?
I don't know.
It's got to be soon.
Yeah.
Because now it's snowing. It was snowing last night.
Was it?
Yeah, it was in Westchester. There's snow on the ground.
Oh, there was none in the city.
Yeah, but it was windy all weekend.
I was in Fort Lauderdale. It was lovely. 80 degrees.
The weather's a little better down there?
Yeah. Well, not that I would know. I just stayed in the hotel room, did nothing.
Do you feel like when you leave Fort Lauderdale and you realize that it was warm the whole time and you come back here and it's just shit? That maybe you should have gotten outside a little more? Does that not even occur
nah,
to you?
You know, I went out and did radio in the morning on Friday. I'm like, what am I going to do? I'm by myself. I was bored.
Yeah?
Yeah. It's like, if I'm traveling, if I have somebody with me, but they just had local two people who live down there, so it's, you know, I was just bored.
You could find a Denny's and walk to the Denny's, you know?
Or Uber.
You could Uber, but you're getting outside.
Oh, yeah, you could walk.
You know what I mean? Like, sometimes I'll be like, oh, I'll take this mile-long walk when I'm traveling if there's nothing to do.
You also don't like spending money on cabs.
No, but I mean, if I have the time,
yeah, that's
you might as well give it a
decision.
Walk. Plus, I say to myself, I'll walk a mile to a Denny's, and then I'll be able to eat whatever I want, and I'll walk off the calories on the way home.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, no.
You have a lot more of those moments. It sounds like a fun way to live.
It is.
Walk them out of Denny's, work off those calories on the way home.
That's it. And you get to enjoy the weather. It's so lovely. How was Fort Lauderdale?
It was good. I mean, the gigs were great.
Did you see Powell?
Yes.
I saw on her Snapchat. You made her Snapchat.
You know, it's funny. I didn't even know she was down there. And she had sent me a message that I never got. So I was down there. I happened to see her Instagram on Thursday.
That must have driven her fucking crazy. What a fucking dude you are. The hot chick is like, hey, Jim. Hey. How funny is it? It's the same name as like the American Pie Kid. Isn't his name Jim in that movie?
Yes.
Jim. Hey, Jim. Pow is Shannon Elizabeth to your Jim.
Yeah. I don't
Jim,
think she
I'm
was
going to go to the show. Jim, are you going to be there? And she shows up, and you don't text her back because you didn't get the message.
I didn't see that she had texted.
That's such a pimp move, though, dude.
I know, but I'm not a good pimp. I'm very weak.
So the pimp hand is not strong?
No, not at all. It's bent over at the wrist. I happened to see her Instagram, and she said something about Fort Lauderdale on her Instagram.
Yeah.
So I texted her on Thursday, and it was already late. So I was like, all right, we'll get together. And I totally forgot on Friday. I'm like losing my mind. I totally forgot Friday.
Did, man, because you're a pimp.
And then Saturday, I was like, oh, yeah, she's here. So after my late show, I met her and her two girlfriends at a club.
Oh.
And I was only for 2 hours. I mean, it was almost like a hip-hop club outside. It was so not my scene.
Oh, it wasn't?
No.
Is that why you stay in your hotel room? Because you're like, or I could go to the hip hop club.
I didn't know it was a hip hop club. Like, I didn't care. I mean, everybody was fine.
Yeah.
It was just her and her two girlfriends. We just sat there. Nobody.
You guys didn't dance?
No, but one of her girlfriends asked me to dance. Her friend, who didn't speak perfect English, but she was asking me to go in there and dance. I was going to, but I told her I had a bum knee.
That's super attractive, though. Yeah. At least it's a good, cool reason to not dance.
No, I didn't say that.
Sorry, baby. I got a bum knee.
Yeah, I hurt my knee, babe. No, I just told her I can't dance.
That's what you said?
Yeah.
I don't have the ability?
I don't have the ability. But it was fun. It was like 20 minutes from the hotel. And I went home. I went back to the hotel and like slept for 2 hours. What's that? No, they were okay. They were cute.
Yeah.
But I was just happy to be out of the room for 2 hours. And then I went back and flew out at 7 in the morning. So
Pal's blonde now, right?
Yeah, I didn't even realize it was a different hair color.
What?
I'm so fucking non-observant. That's why women hate me.
It's the opposite. She used to have very dark hair, and now she's blonde.
Yeah.
You didn't notice it, though.
Yeah. And then she's like, yeah, I just did my hair. I'm like, oh my God, your hair's blonde.
Yeah, I didn't notice. If you had changed the titties, I would have noticed. But
I probably would have, yeah.
Yeah. The hair, I haven't made it up there yet, babe.
Yeah, I just didn't notice.
Oh, what a classy gentleman.
I'm just not observant.
She didn't go to the show, though?
No, I was going to invite her, but she was with her friends. I'm like, oh, she's not having fun with her friends.
Right.
I was going to ask her to come to the late show Saturday, but I don't like inviting people to my show.
Why not?
It's embarrassing. Come watch me. It's embarrassing to say to somebody I know. They could feel like it puts them on the spot. Then they're obligated to come watch me. And what if it's not good? You know, I'm always afraid of that.
But like one of the reasons that Pal likes you is because you're a famous comedian, right?
I'm a moderately well-known comedian.
Yeah, but in her world, you're a very famous comedian.
No, I think in her world, I'm a moderately well-known comedian. But I don't know. I don't think of it that way. I just think of I'm putting people on the spot, and I'm inconveniencing them by asking them to come to the show. And then, like I'm saying, it seems too narcissistic to say to somebody who I know, come look at me. I just feel embarrassed to do it.
Yeah, but that's what you do for a living. And they're like people like that.
Yeah.
And there are people who are actually polite and don't want to ask you. Like, they're like, I don't want to ask for free tickets.
You're right.
I know that's
probably it, partially, too, is that they don't. But I just didn't for that reason. I'm like, yeah, she's not having fun with her friends. I don't want her to feel obligated to come and then tell me it was a good show. I get so in my head when people I know come to see me. Then they're going to tell me it was good, even though Saturday was great. But like, they would say it was good, even though I'll know it wasn't good. It's fucking a mental illness. I just don't want to deal with it.
Plus, I bet she was sitting there in the club like, oh, who does Jim have with him? Who does he have with him that he didn't want me to come to the club? It was another strong move.
Are you thinking that one? No.
Oh, yeah. It was another strong, because it seems like, you know, like you're interested, but not that interested.
I think you're misreading.
Is that right?
Yes, I think you're completely misreading the interaction.
Am I giving your skills of being a smooth operator too much?
Yes, and you're giving her interpretation of it. She's just like, okay, I'll see him later. It'd be good to see my friend for a couple hours when he's here.
Right, so you're saying she could give two shits whether you invited her or not?
Yeah, I don't think she cared at all.
Right, okay.
I think she was happy to see me. It was a nice surprise because she's just there with her two girlfriends. But no, I don't think because she's married. She's seemingly happily married.
I guess so.
I don't think my pimp hand meant anything.
You don't think so?
No.
Not this time.
No, I had no vibes from anybody when I was down there. Like zero. There was a table full, two tables full of women at the late show Saturday. Fucking hot.
At your show?
Yeah. And I didn't realize they were all women there. I just was like, I'm so used to couples. And so I'm asking one of them, I'm like, you guys want to get there? Like, yeah. I'm like, where's your husband? They're like, they're away. And they were all the Miami Dolphins wives.
What?
The Miami Dolphins wives.
Oh,
they were lovely.
I bet they were lovely, but yeah, I would say you're probably not getting vibes.
I pointed that out to the audience. I have zero shot because I'm certainly not more famous than their husbands. I don't make more money than their husbands. I'm not better built than their husbands. I have nothing going for me.
No.
Not one vibe.
No. You might be funnier. You might be funnier than
some of them. Some
maybe.
Of those guys are probably funny.
They probably are.
I'm funnier than half of them.
Right.
Half the Dolphins.
Right. Oh.
Their wives are hot too, man.
I'll bet football players tend to not date ugly women.
Athlete wives are really lovely.
They do not like cows, do they?
No.
No, they don't.
No, you don't,
see
a lot of big fatties. Who? Oh, I'm the tight end's wife. No, you're not.
No, you're not.
Here's Aunt.
Oh, my God.
I don't know if she was there. Wow.
I don't know who she is, but they make reality shows based off of the fact that athletes' wives are hot. That's the whole premise of the shows. So yeah, I would say, it doesn't throw you off your game at all?
No.
When you got a table full of athlete wives there?
No, I know I can have fun. I didn't know they're athlete wives till the end.
Oh.
But no, whenever there's a table full of women, you can always, as long as they were good, and they were good. They weren't like a crazy bachelorette party. Those are the fucking worst. They were fine. They were laughing and they weren't heckling or talking.
Because the bachelorette parties tend to think it's about themselves.
They're the worst. Yeah. Whenever you see somebody with a cup with a penis on it, you're like, oh, shit.
But they're like, we're funny too. Look at our cups with penises.
But no, they were, they I saw one group, I saw, whenever you see a girl with a fucking tiara on, you're like, oh, this is going to blow. Whenever there's a crown on a woman's head in an audience, it's going to suck.
Yeah.
But it it was, there's a table of girls. They were, everyone was fine. They're very talkative in that room. The Friday, they were chatty. But, you know, me and Colin talked about it. And he thinks because they're all coked up and young. But no, nobody was heckling. They just chat, and it's a loud room. But the Saturday was good.
That's good. Let's go to Kevin in Philly. Kevin, welcome to Jim Norton and Sam Roberts.
Is this Kevin?
That it is. Hello, James.
Hi.
Just wanted to use it so
yeah,
bad.
Yeah, we got to take the pause out of the beginning. Just go right to the hi. Thank you. Yes.
James, question for you.
Sure.
So let's say you get a call from Russ and Powell, and they go, hey, Jimmy. I'm not going to do an accent. Never mind.
Team.
Yes.
So they say, hey, Jim, we're going to get a hotel room. Myself, Pal, and Russ, we're going to bang, but we want you to sit in the corner and jerk off. What would you do?
I would do that if they said, if they, instead of the room, they said the lobby.
You'd be fine with that?
Yeah, I don't know. It would be, you know, she's really hot, but something tells me that Russ puts it to her pretty good. That's just my impression, because Russ is a quiet guy.
Right.
He's not, like, arrogant, and he's not cocky. Like,
he does his talking between the sheets.
I wasn't going to phrase it quite like that, but you might be right.
Yeah.
Yeah, I would watch that, of course. Who wouldn't?
All right, that's
but I get no. I don't get any of those vibes, though. It's unfortunate.
No, I don't.
I get none of those vibes
from Pow. You mean?
Nah. No. I mean, I'm not the guy who misinterprets every woman's vibe as wanting to fuck me. Like, I'm actually pretty good at seeing when they don't, because I'm used to it.
Right.
And so I understand the friendship vibe.
You know when it's just like, oh, that's fun, Jimmy.
Yeah.
And that's what yeah. it is. That's all it is. Sometimes.
Yeah.
That's a bummer.
That's what all it is most of the time.
Is that right?
But from a married woman, I don't care. I don't feel bad. I hate getting that vibe from somebody who's single. Like, when there's somebody who's single who you think that you might have an energy with.
And there's no reason not to, right? Unless it's just not there. Because if they're married, you can convince yourself, well, if they weren't married, maybe there would be a vibe. But she's not putting it out there. You know what I mean?
Well, they're married. She's not looking that way. You
right.
know, married people a lot of times don't even focus on outside stuff.
But when somebody's single, they've made a conscious effort and decision to be like, not you.
I could, but yes.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
No genital touching for you.
No, none for you. Why not? Simply because I don't want to.
I prefer
to.
Not to, yeah.
Yeah.
You don't do anything for me sexually.
Right.
That's the worst.
Yeah. Yeah, I could see where that wouldn't feel nice.
No.
That wouldn't feel nice.
But I get a lot of that.
You do?
Yeah.
That's a bummer.
For people I don't mind having as friends, I'm okay with it. I only care if it's somebody I want to sleep with.
Right.
A lot of times you're relieved. Like, I got some female friends, I'm happy. I don't want to date any of them.
Yeah. But if you're like sitting there, and you're keeping this woman company, and you are not entertained by her, like you're not having a good conversation, but you know why you're there, it tends to get frustrating.
Shit, man, it's the worst. It's just as bad, though. Anybody being married, like half the marriages. I saw Kelsey yesterday. She's in town, and we ate something, and she said she saw a TED Talk.
Oh, I did her fucking makeup video.
Oh God,
by the
yeah,
way.
I saw the photo. How was
I
it?
I hated it.
Why?
I just hate doing that stuff. I don't know why I did it, but yeah, I did. I did the makeup video, and I just drew all over her face.
Yeah, I saw it. It was good.
Yeah.
Well, I didn't see the video, but I will watch
it. The video's not out yet. I think she's putting the video out this week.
But she said something interesting about...
By the way, and I don't mean to interrupt you again, but that is the power that, like... Because Kelsey's a pretty hot chick.
Yeah.
And that's the power that they have. Like, there is no... I can't imagine... Like, if you were like, hey, Sam, I get my buddies together and we do each other's makeup on YouTube. Don't you think that'll be fun? I'd go, no, Jim.
You like, why would I want to go over there and just come in my pants?
That's it. That's
yeah,
the problem.
Plus, you know, she's a comic, so it's silly.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And she makes it fun.
Yeah, it's different. I mean, there's no erotic energy to it.
None whatsoever.
But she said something about a TED Talk. She saw a TED Talk, and the woman was talking about marriage, and she said over 50% of marriages fail.
Yeah.
And the woman said, if Apple put out an iPhone and over half of them didn't work, like, when you look at it like that, like, why get married?
Yeah.
So I kind of envy my married friends. Like, I envy you, and a part of me doesn't.
Yeah, I mean, getting married is fun. You know what I mean? Like, the wedding itself is fun. And there is something good about, like, being like, okay, this is my person. I don't need to fucking be on the hunt all the time.
Right.
You know? Because you're on the hunt all the time. And it's like you get married to a girl that you like, that you're attracted to, and you don't have to be on the hunt. And the intention is for it to be forever, but I don't even know if you can, like, when you're getting married in your 20s or 30s, I don't think you're thinking to your 50s or 60s. You're just like, yeah, this seems like what I'll be doing, I guess, forever. We'll see what happens, right?
I don't even want to get married. I'm at a point now where I wouldn't mind seeing somebody regularly and having somebody over.
But like, don't you think that like, you know, I would say 98% of boyfriend girlfriend relationships end, but you still do it.
Sure.
Because the good part's good.
I told you, a massage therapist told me that one time. It was a weird one. She was somebody I never slept with, unfortunately, her choice. And she said the smartest thing to me. She's like, you get hurt at the end of every relationship. No matter what happens, you're going to get hurt.
Yeah.
You're going to get married, fall in love, and they're going to die, or you're going to break up.
Right.
Or you're going to die. Like, one of the ways it's going to end hurtful. So as long as you accept that going in.
You either get hurt or you're going to die.
Yeah, that's it.
Because you could die quick and then you won't get hurt, but you'll be dead.
Even if you wind up hating the person and dumping them, it still fucking hurts.
Yes.
So it's like, you can't be afraid of that. So I'm not afraid of that.
No, you just go for the good stuff. I like being married because, like, it gives you confidence. Because you know, especially if you know you're not going to cheat, like, you can convince yourself that there is a vibe with a girl. And you don't have to figure out if you're right or not.
See, I'm too greedy for that. You're not. I'm a greedy person.
Uh-huh.
That's all it is with sex. I'm greedy.
Right.
So I'm not good at throwing the feelers out there.
Right. And just being like, yeah, I think I could, but I won't. And that's fun. That's not enough for you.
Yeah, I like secrets.
You do?
I realize that. I like secrets, man. I'm sneaky. I like secrets.
That's your collection?
Yeah. It's like, I like implied stuff. I like all that weird. You know what? Maybe I wouldn't. I don't know. Most of the girls I flirt with, I don't fuck. I very rarely have sex, so maybe.
Yeah, but when you flirt, like, how much flirting do you have to do? Like, do you have to flirt to the extent that if a girlfriend saw the text, she'd be like, what the fuck?
What the fuck? She'd throw my phone in the tub.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'd be in Dutch.
That might go beyond flirting, you know?
Yeah. But I kind of envy the married people once in a while. Not the bullshit you guys put up with. So many guys call in and the sex stuff and the women don't fuck you. And there's a million reasons not to be married.
Yeah.
But I see some of the nice stuff about it, which is just relationship stuff, which I kind of miss.
And, you know, and you have to go in realistically. You can't really, you have to compromise a little bit, but you just don't put up with shit. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, it's, if your sex life is dying a slow death, it's kind of up to you to fix it a little bit, right?
I would think so, yeah. Unless you just have lost interest. Like, that happens too. People are together for a while. They have a kid. One loses interest. The woman, oh, I'm a mom now. Or, oh, she's a mom. You know,
yeah.
I've heard that too many times.
Then just go out and cheat and don't get caught. Like, you know what
Dude,
I mean?
It's too hard. That's great in 1980, but it's fucking very hard
yeah,
now.
Yeah, I guess that's true.
Facebook, Twitter.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know you're in trouble. They start liking your tweet. I wonder what it is for married guys today. Like, or if you're in a, like, what is it that starts panicking married guys today? Like, back in the days, if I had a girlfriend and the fucking phone started ringing, I was like, oh, shit. But, like, what is it now when you're married?
I know guys. I was talking to one guy I know who's married. It was like a public figure. But even as a public figure, his wife, like, if he follows a girl on Twitter, not if a girl follows him, but if he follows a girl right. back, she'll be like, who the fuck is that? What are you following her for?
Ooh.
You know what I mean? It's little things like that. Like, what are you following her for?
Because no.
Once you follow them, DMs, and we all know it goes down in the DM.
Yeah, but I'm actually, you gotta be careful in DMs though, because that shit can get like outed or whatever.
Or so, you're just fucking sloppy and you tweet it by mistake.
Yeah, you gotta be careful of. But watch what you say in DMs. People are careless.
Are they?
Wasn't that Wiener? Didn't he do all this shit in DMs?
A lot of DMing.
A lot of bad DMing.
But like, that's no different than text messaging. You can screen grab a text message. You can screen grab a direct message. It's the same shit.
It is, but it's just something about, there's something about it. But it's also outside people have access to your accounts.
To like, DMs?
Like
Twitter.
A password or something. At least your phone is in your possession. You know what I mean? People give out way too much personal info in DM. It's crazy.
Yeah.
Like, you can talk, but just don't be a fucking...
Right. At a point, you give the phone number. And you move over there.
Yes, even though your number could get out that way, but who cares? Just
right.
Change it.
Exactly.
I don't have anything crazy.
But you do iCloud, right?
No.
Oh, because I was going to say they could.
I told you I got to do my phone. Yeah, I'm not going to talk about that anymore.
Yeah. But you taking photos with Pow reminded me that I haven't spoken to you about like the new 90 Day Fiancé.
No.
Because you wanted to fuck the woman who married Muhammad, right?
No, I did not.
Oh.
Oh no, I think we got an update on. Didn't that poor girl get dumped?
Well, you, I want to show. It's a.
Oh, I don't remember. Maybe I'm thinking of someone else.
So, you remember Danielle and Muhammad? We used to play him on on the morning show. Danielle was the big fat woman.
She's a heavy lady. Yeah.
No, she's fairly heavy.
She's heavy.
She had a couple of lazy eyes too.
Did she? I don't remember that. Oh.
Yeah, two lazy eyes. She had that that big puffy nose. Like she just really. Really looked to be in bad shape, and they've been doing a reunion series for 90 Day Fiancé. Yeah. And they've been taking their couples like Russ and Power on it. That's what they were in promoting when we first started doing this. But they've been showing, like, instantly after these two got married. So this big woman, Danielle.
Oh, God. Yeah, I was thinking of someone else.
Look, you want to hear from her? This wasn't one of the things I sent you, was it?
Yes, it is.
Oh, okay.
Let me see. Awkwardness about intimacy.
Yeah. Go ahead and play this.
Me and Muhammad are still married. Muhammad, are you going to make some for me, too?
You're going to eat with me.
Okay.
I came from Tunisia. I left everything there. I changed all my plans to come to the United States.
Dopey music.
It really is.
Me and Muhammad are intimate. We kiss. We hug. But we do it in private.
How are you?
Fine. How are you?
By the way, here, pause for a second.
She just sat down in the worst outfit ever. She wears terrible outfits.
You think so?
Yes.
Their body language is my favorite thing ever. They just went down to sit down on the bed, and Muhammad has his arms real tight, and he's staring at his phone. And she just sits down next to him and goes, "How are you?"
And they're sitting right there, and she looks like her arms like she's ready for some touching, and he looks like he's on the fucking back of an Eric B. and Rakim album. Fucking arms crossed.
You mean Muhammad is standing in his B-boy stance?
Yeah, he's got his arms crossed.
He really does. He looks like a Middle Eastern B-boy.
Yeah, he's none too pleased.
And look at her. You could tell. You see her big fat arm? You see how it's like diagonal?
It's on his leg.
Yeah, she's rubbing that thigh of his.
Yeah, poor lady.
He is not returning the favor.
No, he's not.
And she asks how he's doing. Like, she sits down on the bed right next to him. How are you doing? And he goes, "I'm fine," staring right at the phone.
Can we see that again when she sits?
No eye contact.
Okay, let's see her sit down.
But we do it in private.
How are you?
Fine, how are you?
Oh, did you see her head in that clip? She started to lean in towards his shoulder and to try to, like, look over his shoulder onto the phone and get all close. And he just kind of pulls away. He really is fed up with her.
Well, let's see. Maybe there's more here.
Okay, no, you're right.
But we do it in private.
How are you?
Fine, how are you?
We are like every other married couple.
Since we got married, we've had many ups and we've had many downs.
He's on his phone.
Yeah,
Muhammad has brought up divorce, and it's usually when we're fighting.
Well, yeah, I hope so.
And then when we settle down, we will think, like...
By the way, rule of thumb, I would say when you're, like, fighting with your wife and everything, like, does divorce, of course, you know, at some point in a marriage, the word divorce is going to get thrown around when things get really heated. Not in the first 6 months. Not right away, though. Not in the first six.
Yeah, especially not when you're grateful to be in the country.
Right, right. When you're depending on your marriage for your citizenship, usually, you know, the big D word might pop up.
Danielle?
No, I didn't mean Big D.
See, the thing is,
I married a woman named Big D.
We all see ourselves in Danielle. See, I don't see myself in Muhammad. Uh-huh. I see myself in Danielle.
Right.
Just the fucking... The person with the much more attractive partner,
right,
who you want to like you. Ugh.
And by the way, Muhammad is not a prize.
No, but he's not a bad looking guy. He's in better shape than a guy she would probably get. Let's, in fairness, she's a big lady. He's a younger, in shape guy who probably does not. That's probably not what he saw himself doing.
Do you think he's physically attracted to Danielle?
You know, I would say the odds are not in favor of that being true.
Go for it.
We think more, and then we will give another chance.
And sometimes when we're fighting, he'll strap this thing to his chest and he'll run to my bedroom door yelling noises. And he pulled a string and nothing happened. I said, "What are you doing?" And then he walked out of the room quietly.
He threatened a suicide bomber bedroom. So, like, as the show is going on, he's sitting there and he ends up leaving town. Like, immediately. Not only is he talking about divorce, but he leaves. I can't remember where they live. In some small town in the Midwest. Maybe Oklahoma. I don't know for sure. He lives in some small town. And they go, and they're there. But as soon as the reunion season starts, he goes to Florida to meet up with some other chick. He goes to, he meets a girl online. And he finds another girl that he wants to spend time with. And she goes, okay, well, sometimes he goes on vacations.
She lets him do it?
Yeah. Like, she's like, I don't know what I'm going to do. Muhammad just left. And he just leaves. And that the whole season is like, she's threatening him with divorce. And he's arguing that, like, that shouldn't affect his citizenship. Maybe they should get divorced. But he's in America now, so he shouldn't have to leave.
She should just, well, you know, it's kind of her fault. She just got to divorce him and let him go. But look at me, I'm all involved all of a sudden. But you just got to divorce somebody and let him go. Like, if you had, you're married, Travis, to Lisa. If you had gotten divorced, in, like, within the first year,
yeah,
no kids, would she have had to go back?
I don't think, no, she wouldn't have had to go back, but I do think it's harder for her to stay in once her 2 years is up and she has to get her 10 year.
Well, you could probably get it annulled, though. Let's say, God forbid,
yeah,
you marry Lisa. You're going, well, I've been with Lisa for a couple of months, and
is that how I sound?
We've had our ups and downs, and Lisa is, like, ignoring you and going to hang out with other dudes in Florida and just
yeah.
doing whatever she wants, and you're like, I don't know where
she's vacationing,
Lisa is.
Yeah, with people you don't know. She's like, where was she? She was in Compton. And then she...
Doesn't sound like Lisa.
But if you had said, I don't want to be in this marriage in the first 6 months. Oh, so she might have trouble re-upping after.
Yeah, I mean, she would get to stay for the duration of her 2 year visa, but I don't know how hard it would be for her to get the 10 year one.
Unless she met someone else and got married again.
Right.
If you marry someone outside the country,
yeah,
are they automatically able to come in or no?
No.
They're not?
No.
Okay,
no, you have to get them to apply,
yeah. 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 Now, do you think you'd try to work on maybe getting the marriage annulled at that point, or would you just kind of let Lisa be Lisa?
Yeah, I mean, I would probably try to get it annulled.
Yeah, I would yeah. say.
You shouldn't be going on separate vacations within, like, what, a few months?
Well, it's not like he's going on vacation by himself. And he did it all for the TV show. He met a blonde in Florida, and he went to go stay with her.
Oh. And that's not a
big deal. Well, it doesn't the truth come out? Why did they stop? Who the fuck is that lady?
Well, she's hosting the reunion special at the end of the season.
Is she black or white or just tan?
She's black.
Oh, she's really hot.
Yeah. Yeah, I know. You don't see ethnicity, though. That's why you were asking. Is she black or white or Asian or Hispanic?
My first thought was that she was a tan white lady.
Mm-hmm.
She just looked like an old Florida lady.
No, she's she's a black lady.
She's very attractive.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, she's got them all in the room. Okay.
Yeah.
Like two hens we are. I just want to hear this part, and I want to hear the truth comes out. What was he up to?
Why
did they have stopped having sex? I got to hear this.
You want to hear why they stopped having
sex?
Yeah,
I want to hear this, because, again, she's sitting across with her little feet out, and
right.
He's got his arms folded again.
Now, does it look to like Danielle's lost weight?
Let me see. You know what? I was actually thinking that. Hold on.
Let's see.
You know what? I was thinking she might have lost some weight. No.
Okay. Yeah, yeah. No,
she,
you're right.
Not.
She has not lost, not a pound.
No.
But
then again, neither is he.
Good point.
In fairness, guys.
Good point. What's good for the goose is good for the gander.
Yes, cake.
So they're sitting there, because they said in the last clip that they were intimate, right? They said that they are like any other married couple, and they're intimate. So I would love to know if sex was a problem. Let's see.
When we saw the scene of you two at the wedding, you said that you could not kiss her.
Yes.
Okay.
Oh, yeah, that was the other
Why
thing.
Have you guys ever kissed?
Did she have bad breath?
When they got married, first he said he wouldn't kiss her because it was against his religion. Then even after they were married, he said he couldn't kiss in public. So the moment where everybody's sitting there watching them going, you may now kiss the bride, he's like, no, can't do. Like he said, he goes, nah, can't do it. My religion.
I think he's just embarrassed.
You think so?
I think he's embarrassed that his friends home are going to see this.
You don't think one of the pillars of Islam is you can't kiss your wife?
No, I think once you know what? I don't know. Certain ultra hardcore, there's some where you can never see the girl's face.
Yeah.
Like I read one story of a woman who killed her husband because he saw her face.
Mm-hmm.
Some weird, like that was a really fucking militant. But I don't think in that, he's obviously not that or he wouldn't be here.
Right. I was about to say, like, okay, one
they
of the
don't
rules.
On TV.
Yeah. You can't kiss your wife in public. I would assume that would also mean you can't meet a hot blonde in Cocoa Beach and move in with her
yeah,
for a while.
Yeah. It also means you can't move to America, dress however you want, you know?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah, so he decided not to kiss her on their wedding day.
I think
day.
It was a conscious decision he made, yeah.
You think, what do you think her breath smelled like on the wedding day? Because I'll tell you this, she was nervous. He wasn't going to show up at first. He wasn't around the house. He was out.
I'm going to guess, like, dry, sour breath. Like, you know that dry, sour, arguing breath? Remember, you know arguing breath? When you've been arguing with someone, the breath that smells like a sinus. You know that breath that smells like the back of someone's sinuses when you kiss them? their mouth is dry and it smells like they've been coughing.
Yeah, because you've been yelling so much and all your saliva's out of your mouth. Because she was crying and she was yelling at her daughters, "Where's Muhammad?"
Yeah, it smells like a damp foot.
Ugh. And I would say that our starting position as far as breath goes on her is not the greatest.
You'd hope, you know, some people have wonderful dental hygiene, but some people don't. And I don't know. If someone doesn't want to kiss you on your wedding day, like if they can't fake a smooch, that's bad. I mean, there's very few women I couldn't kiss for the TV cameras.
Right.
I mean, Jesus Christ.
Yeah, that's the best part about Muhammad. Like, there is no part of, like, he doesn't seem to be concerned with the immigration part of this. Like, and he doesn't want to move out of America. He keeps saying, "I'm staying here."
Maybe he doesn't understand.
And lawyers, he goes to a lawyer, and the lawyer's like, "Well, you know, no, you gotta stay married. I wouldn't go to Florida if I were you." And then the next scene, he's like, "The lawyer said I couldn't go to Florida, but, you know, I'm a free man. It's America, so
I'm gonna go." He probably
knows
she won't just boot him out of the house. He'll probably just come in. What he does, he probably gives her a fuck. Probably fucks her once in a while. Whenever she gets mad, he probably puts her on her stomach and fucking gets in there with two rubbers on.
Well, he's got a reason why it doesn't happen more normally.
Well, let me hear this. I didn't hear what this is. I would like to know the reason. I didn't plan on chatting about this today, but I am interested in what happened with this couple.
Good, good, good.
Had you guys ever kissed before that?
Yes.
You have?
Yes.
Were you intimate before that?
Yes.
You have. Okay, so you've kind of consummated the relationship, mm-hmm. really. Was there any intimacy after the wedding at all?
After the wedding?
Yes.
There was, but we started facing a problem.
What was the problem?
Hold on, let me see.
I don't want to say.
I'm going to guess politics.
You think they
politically they were different?
Yeah.
She was a Trump supporter, he was not.
Yeah.
That was it? Is that it? No?
He just doesn't find himself attracted to Republicans, you think?
I think so. Or her glasses. I don't like women who cannot see clearly. Maybe that's it?
Maybe that's it.
I'm going to guess the glasses.
By the way,
her hairdo?
Her hairdo and her glasses have both changed for this special. On the TV show, she had brittle, dry, orange-looking hair. And her glasses, you know how, like, a person who never cleans their glasses has those, like, yellow water stains on them? Like, it's almost like
thumbprints and stuff.
Yeah, it's like, it almost, like, is a cake over it. She always had that on her glasses.
I feel, she's much older than him, too, right?
She is quite a bit older than him. Yeah, that's a good. See, she looks a little. Oh, she should leave the glasses on. She's not. She's like Travis. Like, they're not faces that are meant to be worn without glasses.
It's right there. Travis, comment.
Sam has historically always mentioned that I don't look good with my glasses.
Let me see without your glasses. You look bad without your glasses.
Those beady little eyes are the things
Jim.
Of nightmares.
No, you look equally awful. Now, we're just used to seeing you without your glasses.
Yeah, I mean, I've had them since I was in fifth grade.
So. Yeah,
I remember.
Better. Yeah, I know you
yeah,
do.
Yeah, all of a sudden, I don't know who the man was. I couldn't see him in court.
Yeah. All right, let's see what she said.
Like, this is very private. Instead of taking care of that problem, she was, like, fighting with me over it. This is something that no man in the world can accept that.
Okay,
and
hit pause. No man in the world can accept that. What could it be? Nipple hair?
She has a dick.
I can think of one man in the world that would accept that.
You bet you can. What? No man can accept that.
Yeah.
I think he's talking about no man can accept her fighting with him.
No, he's talking about the problem.
The problem. He's saying there's a problem.
She was fighting. Here's the deal. They encountered a problem in their sex life. Instead of taking care of the problem, she was fighting with him, and no man can accept this problem.
Well, okay, it's going to be one of two things.
Oh, no.
He finds her physically just unattractive, or there's an odor. Oh, God, I hope it's not that. I'm a mean person, and I hope it's not that.
You don't want there to be an odor?
No.
You don't even want to make fun of her on that level.
I feel kind of bad. I'm just getting older. Yeah, she's just a big fat lady who wants a young dick.
Yeah. She just wants a young dick, and the young dick is just curling up.
I just want to hug her. I want to hug her and then push her into an elevator shaft.
Go back.
I feel bad for her.
Go back just a little bit. So you're worried.
She's also stupid. I feel bad for her.
She is stupid.
But she's also, it's like, you know what I mean? Like, you got to, when you're shooting so far out of your league, you got to understand what the dynamics really are.
Yeah, like Danielle was meant to have a relationship with a big fat man in overalls who might hit her every now and then.
Or a guy like, who doesn't mind hitting her. You know, some guys don't care, man. They can just literally pound any woman. There's guys like that.
Who are just looking to throw a fuck into something.
Dude, guys like that, I'm in awe of you. I've said this before. There's guys that could just climb onto any girl and stick it in any hole and just pump away without looking and fuck for an hour. Like, there's guys that like... can do that.
Adrian, you've had your share of fat women, right?
I sure have.
Okay.
Have
now.
Mm-hmm. And what's not an insane amount, but I've had
it. But it's like, because you get to those evenings where you're like, I don't want to do the work. I just want something that is going to be a little easier, a little more my speed, and I want to just have fun.
Yeah, but not like...
Not for Danielle?
Like Danielle, no. Well, I actually have talked to Troy how I slept with a girl once who I had considered around a two, and this makes me think no, because Danielle is much...
Lower than a two?
Yeah.
But do you know the problem that he's about to announce? You watch this.
I don't know what it is, so don't spoil it, because I really am going to enjoy it. But I do remember Patrice was fucking this big fat lady, and he would refer to her as the fat bitch from The Wiz. That was my favorite thing. This was when he lived in Jersey City, and he was so embarrassed. He said she was too fat to even like to even acknowledge publicly. Like Patrice is like, and I'm fat, but he was like, yeah, I saw the fat bitch from The Wiz. That was his name for her, the fat bitch from The Wiz.
And he couldn't do it.
Oh, he made me laugh. No, he did.
I mean, he couldn't acknowledge her publicly, though.
No,
he couldn't bring her around.
Oh, I wish he was alive for two reasons. A, to talk about her right now.
Yeah.
And B, just to talk about Trump for 2 minutes.
Yeah.
Can you imagine
his take on it?
I just want to wake him up and just go, Trump is the president. And go, what? And then make him die again. So that's what he has to take onto eternity, is the knowledge that happened.
Jim just now, he made motions of holding two ends of a pillow.
Smothering
somebody.
That was me shaking someone awake. That was me like shaking their lapels awake.
Oh.
Like you wake up and then he wakes up and I go, Trump's the president. He goes, really? Yes. And he's dead again.
Yeah. Just let him know.
Yeah, just so he has to take that with him.
I would want to wake up Patrice and let him know what Danielle's big secret was.
I would like to know as well.
Yeah.
Good seg.
Taking care of that problem, she was like fighting with me over it. This is something that no man in the world can accept that.
Oh.
And then she was like, be like sitting on the floor, crying, screaming in front of her teenagers. I want my sex tonight. If you don't give me my sex tonight, I will.
Hit pause.
I will.
The rest of the cast is watching in another room.
Oh.
As Danielle was sitting on the floor, throwing a tantrum in front of her teenagers, saying, I want my sex tonight.
You know, that's how bad she wanted that dick. She brought this young guy over, and she wants to fuck his brains out, and she's not getting the dick. She's like, I provided 50 states,
yeah,
and you're not providing dick.
Is there anything worse than being stupid, ugly, fat, and
you
having...
tell me. Get it? You're not fat, though.
Being stupid, ugly, fat, and having a very healthy sexual appetite? Is that not
terrible
torture? God just decided, not for you. A pleasant life, not for you. You're going to want the thing that nobody will give
That's
you.
That's terrible.
Good dickin'.
That's terrible.
All she wants is Muhammad to penetrate her.
Well,
and he's sitting there going, I'm not doing it. I have to leave the state.
Well, he won't say what the problem is. So I guess he doesn't say what the problem is, or maybe he does.
It does. It comes to light.
Okay.
It does come to light.
In front of her teenagers, I want my sex tonight. What? If you don't give me my sex tonight,
my sex.
I will call the immigration. I will get you deported.
How great is that? Can you imagine? I feel it would make me feel like such a man if somebody wanted my sex so bad that they were going to have me deported if I didn't give them my sex.
That's also a great strategy by her. Like, I admire both of them. I admire his ability to do that to somebody, and I admire her going, you either fuck me or you go back to the shithole from whence you came. She's like, no more, there's no more pretending here.
Yeah.
We don't love each other. You fuck me or you're on a boat.
Yeah, but you know what? If a guy got like a Filipino bride or a Russian bride or something and brought her into this country, and the guy was like, you've got two choices, either suck my dick or get back to the homeland.
Sure.
People would be like, that guy is a monster.
I wouldn't say
that. He had a sex slave.
People would call, because they'd
say like he tricked her into marrying him. He manipulated her. He told her she'd have this great life, and now he's throwing tantrums, sitting on the floor in front of his children, demanding that she fucks him.
Although not if we saw the whole thing played out like on this show. Like, don't forget, on this show we've seen this all played out before. We were seeing them talk,
right?
And we're seeing their interaction. If we saw the interaction, maybe not.
You think she just had a manic moment?
Yeah,
she's like, just fuck me.
Yeah, she's sitting in front. She's got this probably low hanging dick.
Yeah.
She's fucking tapped it before.
God damn it, fuck me or I'm gonna deport you.
You're 8x5. You're packing 8x5.
And her kids are just sitting there watching TV like, yeah, just ignore her. Sometimes she gets like this.
Yeah.
Oh, she's fat and horny.
it's really awful. It's, you know, turn off Al Jazeera. That just gets her going.
She just gets excited by it again. I don't know what it is about these Middle Eastern men.
All right, what does she say? Please, what does she say?
Danielle, can you tell us what he's talking about?
He has told people that I smell and you peed on him.
Oh, God.
Oh, boy. And here's the best part. He's told people I smelled. You do. He was almost like, "Don't. That's not even a problem, bitch. That's not even a maybe."
Yeah, yeah. He was waiting. He's like sitting there because he's going, I'm not going to reveal your big secret, but the minute if you say it, it's out there, and now we can own this.
And here's why she's annoying.
You stink in your pants.
Here's why she's annoying, because she's going, he has told people, not I have a problem,
right,
or I smell. Right there, okay, you do. Please can we hear that again?
Yeah.
Can you tell us what he's talking about? He has told people that I smell, and you I do. Peed on him.
She's leaking piss.
Okay.
No, she's
probably
squirted.
This person here?
I bet what happened was, that's how good the dick is. She got on it once, and... And no one ever made her squirt before.
Right.
She fucking gushed on him.
That's why she's fucking pounding the rug, going, fuck me more.
He made her squirt. He probably got behind her.
Yeah.
Or whatever position she has to be in. And he pounded it so good. He probably had to think of something else. He's probably just thinking of that awful tin door he used to have to open to get in his house.
Yeah.
And he's like, don't go back there. Don't go back there. And he made her squirt.
Yeah.
And it fucking smelled.
Yeah.
Ooh, this is great.
And yeah, she's... And she probably... Do you think she knew that she was a squirter?
I doubt it. Or maybe one guy in high school made her squirt.
She probably hasn't had that much sex.
Yeah.
She's not an attractive...
Well, she's got adult kids. So she's fucked. So she's probably... One guy in high school, probably one guy in a pickup truck, fucked her after a game. He was probably like a football player.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? He was a fucking defensive end. He was a giant guy. He had a fat dick, and he probably pounded her. He was drunk. He had like 13 beers, and he fucked her on the back of a pickup, and she squirted, and she went home with her pants wet, and she was ashamed, but she never forgot what it felt like to have liquid fucked out of her.
Oh, yeah.
And Muhammad's the first one to do it since then.
I wonder if there are guys out there, and I'll bet there are, that are just like truckers or whatever, that are so hard up, if they found out there was some sex-crazed big fat woman that squirts everywhere,
absolutely,
they would absolutely take her up on it.
At 100% they would.
Okay, Adrian, now that you know that she is a fat woman, but you could, if Muhammad can get her to squirt, I think you could get her to squirt.
Oh, yeah.
Would you try it? Because you'd want to see her squirt. Even though it would stink. It would stink real bad.
Yeah, like say it smelled like that stuff that leaks out of the back of a garbage truck.
Just garbage juice shooting out of her vagina.
No, I don't think I could. She's too bad.
Is there a reason for the smell? Do they go more on the smell?
I don't know. Let's
I have
keep
to
playing.
Hear the end of this.
Yeah.
Okay. This person here, she has some stuff that I don't like. I complained about.
You know what? I don't even want to know.
Well, yes, you want a dumb host.
Terrible host.
Terrible host. Boo!
This should be the Fat Lady Squirter Show.
How do you not find out what it is?
What a terrible host.
I don't even... You know what? I'll bet you somebody at an earpiece said, move on.
Dude, it's taped. It's taped.
Oh, yeah, you're right.
Let her go. If I'm that host, I'm sitting there going, I understand that the rest of the cast is sitting in the back room, but they're as captivated as I am right now.
Everyone wants to know what the smell is.
Yeah. Yeah. As far as I'm concerned, it could just be these two.
That's all this show should be. This should be a 2-hour primetime special. What's wrong with her pussy?
Yeah, it's like those "What Would You Do" specials that ABC puts out, except it's "What's Wrong with Her Pussy."
What's wrong with her pussy?
Yeah, Dr. Oz could come in and take it from a medical standpoint. You could get like some porn star to come in and examine it from a like a sex standpoint.
Dr. Steve could go in there with his fucking rubber catcher's mitt.
Oh yeah, he could.
Yeah, she's got folliculitis and she's leaking a dirty fluid from her intestines.
You just have Danielle in a set of stirrups and having a different guy come in every 10 minutes to examine her vagina. China on primetime TV.
Here's the problem. She swallowed a truck tire and a license plate.
We've x-rayed her and we found the problem. We found highway debris in her stomach.
Oh my God, that's embarrassing. That's embarrassing.
The poor lady. She, and you know what? Muhammad didn't say it. It's her fault. She shouldn't have said. He said, "I smell," and I pissed on him.
Or she should have gotten, like, if she's a big lady, you got to take care of that, and you got to shower every fucking time and douche. Do it. Don't just sit around and be lazy about it.
No.
Realize I'm big, and I might pick up a little scent here and there and fucking take care of it right before you fuck.
Yeah, because there is this possibility where she hasn't picked up on this scent. Either she's just used to it or she can't smell down there. Oh, can you? Oof. She just lives with that stench. It's got to be pretty bad. If they're talking about it on national television,
yeah.
It's got to get to a point. Like, Muhammad is like, look, I can put up with a lot. I knew she was an idiot.
I don't even mind that she's Jewish, but I can't tolerate that.
Like, I knew she was an idiot. I knew she was fat. I knew she wasn't an attractive woman. I didn't know the smell would be this bad.
I would love to sit him down and ask him, what was the first time you noticed it?
Oh, can you? I would
the
love
the first time. Was it when before you got here? Did you fuck her?
Yeah.
Or was it not bad the first time? And I want to know, ask her, when's the first time he mentioned it to you? Because you don't mention it the first time.
Mm-hmm.
You can't. You can't just go PU the first time. So you probably get it in there at one point. Like, hey.
Yeah. But would you allow Muhammad to come in the studio? You would talk to him?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, boy, would I.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, as far as, and this show, like, you know, it's mostly housewives and stuff that watch 90 Day Fiancé. So Muhammad has become, like, the biggest Middle Eastern villain since Jafar from Aladdin to all of them. Like, everybody hates him.
Do they?
Hates him.
Why?
For the way that he's treated her.
Oh, because they see
themselves in her.
Yeah, but it's also, as a man, you got to realize this, they're mismatched. If he was a big fat guy, then again, you know what? If she was a young hot Russian,
mm-hmm.
and he was the big fat guy, we would be bashing her too. Like, fucking bitch, you knew what you were getting when you moved in,
you know,
so we'd probably be bashing her. Although Siggy Breath, I didn't bash the young Russian girl.
No,
I was bashing Siggy Breath.
Yeah, yeah. Do you want to play the clip when they get in front of the rest of the cast?
Is there more interesting stuff there?
Yeah, they kind of like, because the rest of the cast.
Oh,
is
the
now.
Truth comes out. All right, it's only 2 minutes. We'll just play a little bit. I got to hear what happened. The truth comes out
because the cast is now pissed at Muhammad. Like,
why?
They're all trying to be like, you're awful.
He's not awful.
You're so mean to her. This stinky, stinky woman.
I don't think he's being awful.
You don't think so?
So let me ask you, Muhammad.
Yes.
Do you feel that...
You think TLC knew that they had a gold mine with this couple?
Oh, did they? Let me ask you, Muhammad. You're here for your pilot's license. You know?
Did not know Danielle before you got married?
Yes. I did not know enough about Danielle before I married her. I didn't.
Do you think there's anything specific that he's talking about that he didn't know about
that
Danielle?
The host didn't ask? Yeah, she's trying to get around it.
Yeah.
Because she doesn't want to humiliate the woman. But the woman, you sign up for this. Like, you sign up for this when you come on a show like this. And
right.
You're a big... When you look, I'm realistic. Like, do you think that I would want to be shirtless in front of half... No. That motivated me to work out. Because even though that there's women who would fuck me, I was humiliated to be naked in front of them.
Yeah.
You should be embarrassed to be naked in front of people if you're in terrible shape.
Right. Right. Yeah.
It's not body shaming. That's just... Unless you're banging somebody of equal. But if you're way out of your ballpark...
Yeah.
Then fucking understand it's going to be humiliating to be naked in front of someone who is a lot better shape than you are.
Yeah, did you know Sam Roberts was a skinny fat mess that kind of looks like an alien from Roswell, New Mexico before you moved here? No, I didn't.
Yeah, people
no,
know.
I didn't. They know.
People know.
They know.
Like, I feel like it's like a different person for me.
Do you think you took the K-1 visa program just too lightly?
No, it's not about that. I was expecting, like, way much better than I find out when I came here. Oh, no. So,
do you think you're specifically talking about the pussy?
And the house and the life. A little bit of everything.
Yeah. I tell you this. A very disgusting vagina is going to make a small house feel even smaller.
Yeah, a rotten pussy can ruin any vacation.
He's got a, once you smell that, I'll bet he smells it lingering everywhere.
Everywhere, every seat. Every time she stands up, he probably wants to go smell the seat.
He takes the remote from her and he goes,
Yeah, she was digging in her crotch.
Yes, she was.
He's got hospital gloves on.
Everywhere he goes.
Poor lady.
He's in a hazmat suit.
Bitch, wash your pussy.
So I just started like facing like big challenges in my life, trying to fix the mess that I feel like I was put through. But I did all my best. It didn't work. I tried to fix it. It didn't work.
Okay. Let me ask Danielle and get her take on this. You feel that you did not know Muhammad well enough before you got married?
Yeah.
Because
what he showed me when I went to visit ain't the person that came here.
I bet he fucked her when she visited him.
Yeah, he fucked her with Uncle Sam in his eyes. He saw Uncle Sam.
Exactly. She came to visit him in Tunisia. He put a fucking clothespin on his nose, and he ignored the vagina smell, and he fucked her like crazy, like she's never been fucked
he
before.
He gave her a fucking... I need a visa, third world, deep dicking. He fucked her for the future of his family.
Yes, he did.
Fucked her well.
And then she came back and she was like, look, I gotta fuck. That's why she's obsessed. That's why she won't divorce him. She remembers that romantic trip to Tunisia. And all he's trying to do is live it down.
Yeah, fuck, man.
You feel that he changed right after he came to the United States?
Yes. Because then when I went to see him, he showed me the affection.
You see what she's talking about?
He worked and stuff.
She has a mouth like Bill. Her mouth looks like Bill Clinton. She keeps doing the Bill Clinton when he's upset. Yeah, but you know what? It's just a typical person not fucking owning up to any of their own shit.
Yeah.
It's like, well, you know, you think the guy doesn't want to fuck you. Maybe you should fix part of what's wrong.
She got a new hairdo. She dyed her hair. That might have been the problem. Maybe he doesn't like my hair color.
Yes, exactly. He wanted her to dye it with a guillotine.
Yeah. Your hair and everything between that and your neck is the problem.
Yeah, could you dye your hair with acid? Get into fucking, you know, one of the Iceman's fucking barrels.
He got hair. He didn't show me the affection hardly at all. When he got the chance to work, did not work. He went traveling around the United States.
But why did you tolerate that?
I didn't tolerate it.
You didn't?
No, I did not tolerate it.
I would have sent his ass directly
because
back.
Because there was times when he came back from trips, I had his stuff sitting at the door
one time.
Yeah,
I never would have tolerated it.
And then every time something like that happens, he's on the phone calling the cops.
For what?
I have 10 police reports on me.
Oh, boy. Yeah, she's probably much more of a yeller and a screamer. Yeah, she probably seems like she may have some personality things where she likes to yell. If she sits on the floor screaming...
That she wants dick?
Yeah.
In front of her kids?
Yeah. And maybe she's a yeller. Fuck them.
I would have loved it if you had talked about this with Powell. Like,
I didn't
privately.
Know about it. I'm really bummed I didn't know about it.
Yeah.
I had no idea what was going on. I had no idea she was in Fort Lauderdale spending time down there. I just didn't know.
Right. You
shit.
Didn't know this pussy was stinking up.
That's
half
all
the Midwest.
I would have asked her.
Is that right?
That's all I would have asked her is about this fucking lady's vag.
Because like, you
what
know,
what did we miss? You know, there was a lot of shit cut out. What did I miss?
Yeah. You know, you're on TV. So like, you know, you've got to take the woman's side here. But like, you know, you're not gonna in real life, there's no way that Pow is sitting there sympathetic to this woman. Maybe a little bit, but stinky vagina?
Yeah, man. It's
you can take care of that.
You can't. I wonder if Russ Alpha's the other guys because he's got the hottest wife. Well, there's a couple of them that are really hot.
Yeah, Pow's probably the hottest, but it's there's
Siggy Red had
hot.
A hot girl, and so did the fucking other one. Remember the little girl's gonna model.
Oh my god. Yeah. Yeah. There's a A couple from this season that I got to show you at some point. Maybe not today.
I don't usually typically enjoy reality shows. This was kind of fun to watch. Just because you're watching people whose lives could fall apart.
I might show you tomorrow or maybe next week or something. There's one couple this season that's like the hottest chick you've ever seen from Russia. It's Siggy Breath all over again. And just a big fat guy that keeps spending his money on her.
Gotta watch it, man. You have to go into those things. Like, I'm not saying I'm above meeting a young lady who's way out of my league and trying to seduce her that way.
Right.
But you have to immediately understand what it is.
Look at this picture.
Yeah. Yeah, it's hard to tell from that. She doesn't look like she's in the best shape. Am I wrong? Am I crazy?
No, she's extremely hot.
Oh, she is. Okay.
And she's like all like plastic surgeryed up a little bit. She's got the big lips and the titties and everything.
Yeah, they don't look that crazy together. You know what? His face isn't bad. He might be a fat guy, but he's not that big. Oh, okay, yeah, she's solid.
Yeah. Yeah, show that one of them laying down the top right there.
You know what? I couldn't tell. Like, it looked like her hips were out, but that's because she kind of arches her ass a little bit. Yeah. He's just got to get in better shape.
Yeah.
He's not a bad looking dude. Like, you just got to get in better shape.
She's taking him for a ride. Oh, it's so fun to watch. She is taking him for a ride.
The Russian girls scare me. Russian girls scare me.
Why is that?
They just do. I would never believe a Russian girl liked me for any reason.
Really?
If a Russian girl says hi to me, I'm like, you're lying.
Yeah. Yeah. What's your game here? End game?
What do you want? That always frightens me a lot.
Let's go to Tony in Baltimore. Tony, welcome to Jim Norton and Sam Roberts.
Is this Tony?
Hey, how you doing? I'm a big fan of the show.
Hi, Tony. Thank you, Tony.
So, anyway, I have the Facebook Messenger app. It thinks it's doing you a favor by, like, saving photos. But, like, say I send a dick shot to a girl, it stays on there. So every time you open up the app and click on her name to send her another message, all the pictures you send her are right there, and you can't delete them.
Oh, so you think Facebook?
Maybe
that Messenger app is what
shit
is bad? Yeah.
Yeah. So,
need is somebody, because then they just start scrolling up, and they're able to see all that stuff.
Yeah, you got to be careful.
Like, if my girlfriend's friends with that girl, and she picks up my phone to send her a message, she clicks on her name, and the first thing that pops up is my dick, and it's ridiculous.
That's kind of scary. Again, if you're going to send dick pictures, I would suggest texting them. Just text them, because they can be deleted a little easier. Or just
Snapchat.
Be ready for them to, sure.
I'm hearing like four different shows on this phone right now. I don't know if something's wrong. But anyway, I'm a big fan. Thanks, man.
Yeah, man, you got to watch what you send your dick photos on, unless you don't care.
Well, right, you're right. If
you're married, you better watch where you're sending your dick photos.
Yeah, in general. Let's go to Dan in Florida. What's up, Dan?
Yeah, the other thing you guys aren't talking about with Muhammad is, you know, he thought he's coming to this nice life in America. He ends up with this lump. She's got three... She's got three fat, lump daughters
who
just complain all the time. He's in rural, snowy Ohio, and she's in crippling debt.
Well,
in a tiny apartment.
They're also showing, whenever you watch a reality show, you have to know that you're watching a very, very edited version of their lives. So I never believe 100% of what I'm seeing. Like, it's not all her fault. I guarantee you he's got some shitty things, but this is the way they've painted this one. Like, I think this is probably more to make the women hate him and also to make the guys empathize with him. Like, oh man, what a fucking nightmare this guy's in.
By the way, to answer your previous question, he is 15 years her junior.
Well, how old is he? I'm going to guess he's, 27? She's 42? That's a guess?
Well, when the show first started, that was it. That's probably 3 years ago at this point. It's probably like 45 and 30 now.
Okay, yeah.
Something like that. Maybe
27. Okay.
Maybe less. Maybe 20. Maybe 28. And
fucking Tunisian knife fighter. It's Anthony.
Let's go to JR in Brooklyn. What's up, buddy?
Hey, Junior.
Hey, what's going on, guys?
No.
Jimmy, I wanted to touch on something you said about those Russian girls.
Yeah, they scare me.
You are 100% right. They are fucking scheming fucks. It's almost genetic. They come from a country a couple of years ago. There was no God. There's no rules. They're not scared of anything. They come here. They'll scheme every second of the day if they can. You are 100% right. Those Russian chicks, they look like they're fucking dynamite-looking broads, too. Real good-looking. and they are full of shit, like a whale with no asshole.
Well, it depends on where you meet
them. Like a whale with no asshole, he says.
Yeah, come on. In a Doctor Who shirt. I'm kidding. Poor kid.
I'm from an area in Brooklyn where it's second to Moscow in Russian,
What are you from, Brighton Beach?
Yeah, exactly.
So you know what it is, though, dude? You also got to know the people you're talking to. Like, a lot of those girls come over. If you're talking to strip club workers, like, amazing. They're all 10s, and they come over, and they go in a van, and you know there's some shady shit happening. You're meeting people who have probably come here for a specific reason, and it's financial. Like, if you meet a Russian student, it's probably different. But, like, as men, I'm like you. We look at the hottest chicks,
yeah,
and we try to get the hottest girls. And if you meet an average-looking girl, she's probably not going
to
be like that.
But, by the way, it goes right back to your point. Where you know it's like, oh, this is too good to be true. I'm dating way out of my league.
She's way out of my league. Are you a good-looking guy?
Jim and Sam, guys, I work in law. I'm a cop.
Okay.
I deal with what are regular people.
Oh, okay.
Consider not straight immigrants. These people have been here for a number of years. They're established, and they're fucking scammers. They are fucking worse. There's a pharmacy every 100 feet in Brighton Beach.
Why?
They scam Medicaid, they scam pills,
So they can go in and
whatever they can get their hands on, they do it.
So you're saying it's cultural?
I think it's genetic. It's almost hereditary. It's born, bred to their bones to take advantage of any situation that they can.
You know, I don't know enough about, I'm only going by the girls I've talked to. Who, again, most of them were, if they weren't in strip clubs, they were just hot, they were dancers that I met somewhere else, so they were hot girls. I haven't met enough just Russians in real life that I don't know. Maybe
they're trying to win.
Maybe, yeah.
You know, they're just trying to win.
Thank you, man.
We have a big show today. Ben Bailey's coming in.
Yeah.
Very funny Ben. Comic.
He has a new stand-up special, which I would like to promote. Ben's a very funny stand-up. Hold on, where the fuck is this cocksucker paper? Here it is, therealbenbailey.com, and it's called Ben Bailey Live and Uncensored, and it's $7.99 on the website, or you can get it for $9 on iTunes. And Ben was it's funny, people know Ben from the one of the Patrice roasts, who just massacred everybody. He's a very funny guy.
When we talk to him about that, he also destroyed the lives of cab drivers everywhere, because many of them have to deal with fucking bros getting in the cab and being like, hey, is this a cash cab? And just thinking they're hilarious every time.
Yeah, it's probably annoying to them.
It's gotta be. Craig, our old intern Craig, did that one time when we were in there with him. We also have Gary Busey coming in today. I'm excited about that.
Yeah.
Gary Busey's gonna give us some of his wisdom.
Oh, yeah.
Which should
be fun.
Yeah, it'll be good. I was up a little late last night because I was watching and I was podcasting after it about...
Podcasting?
Just podcasting.
It's a garbage.
About Survivor Series, because they had Brock Lesnar lose in 2 minutes. Like, they just squashed him.
In wrestling?
Yeah. Yeah, WWE had him lose to Goldberg. And it's getting all kinds of mainstream...
What's the use of that for them? And why would he do it?
Why would Brock do it?
Yeah.
I'm sure that Brock kind of has to do whatever they tell him to a big degree.
But why would they wreck such a massive name guy?
I think it's because, number one, they've got Goldberg for a few more shows. So they're going to be able to have him as a big name guy. And number two, wrestling fans forget shit. You know what I mean? Like, Brock is still going to be able to show up. Like, give it a couple months for this to wash over, and Brock is still going to be able to show up and do okay. But it literally, like, wrestling fans either loved it or they completely hated it. Everybody was in shock because the match lasted. They spent all this time building and building and building, and they had, like, 30 minutes left on the show. And the match ended in 2 minutes after three moves.
Do you think that was one of those things where, again, they know that UFC is so big and that it's the unpredictable nature of it, and they wanted to just do something that would shock everybody?
I think that's part of it. I think there is a long-term strategy, too. But I think that's the thing. Like, the last time they had a match, it's wrestling, that mainstream actually talked about, it was when Brock Lesnar beat Undertaker, because it was a shock even to people, to anybody that knows anything. People were shocked that Brock Lesnar beat him. This has that same kind of vibe about it, where the mainstream is included with the wrestling fans. People are just like, what the fuck? what happened last night? Everybody's talking about it, you know?
Yeah, I don't know why they would do that. Unless it's just to establish Goldberg immediately. It's definitely, I don't even watch that stuff, but I'm guessing that's what it would be.
It's definitely to establish Goldberg. And like I said, WrestleMania's in April, the beginning of April, April 1st, I think.
Yeah.
By the time April comes around, people will have still think that Brock Lesnar is awesome. Like,
he'll have a reason for this. Did he give a reason why he lost?
Because he got fucking bested. What do you mean a reason why he lost?
Was he sick or something? Or?
No, he was just bested.
He had a cold?
Goldberg bested him. You know? He came back.
Why does he have the UFC gloves on, Goldberg?
He's always worn those gloves.
Oh, has he? Okay.
Yeah, for a long time. See, like, there's a stare down. Goldberg doesn't look scared. He doesn't look shook.
Brock looks like he's backing up a little bit.
A little bit, right?
Oh, they're doing the thing where they meet in the middle first?
Well, they're just kind of staring down because this is a long time coming. They wrestled each other 12 years ago.
Oh, the ref looks like he's in charge, though.
By the way, the last time Goldberg wrestled was 12 years ago. So this was an unknown. You think the referee's got a handle on this?
No, I don't.
Oh, you don't?
I don't think he's in charge.
You don't think it's like Big John McCarthy in there?
No, I don't. No. Little twerp McGillicuddy. That's the guy's name.
He rings the bell.
Why are they just looking at each other?
It's time to get the thing started. Brock backs him into the corner.
And just throws him in there?
No, but Goldberg shoves him.
How does he shove him down?
Because he's super strong. Have you seen that fucking... Look at the fucking... What are those deals called on the shoulders?
Traps.
Look at the fucking traps on Goldberg. Okay? You don't think Goldberg could shove you on the ground?
Coming up, we have Ben Bailey and Gary Busey. No, I don't.
He's the man.
Cool.
He's the man. So that was a big thing.
He's still on the ground. It was just a shove.
I know.
Because he got speared.
Oh, he probably wasn't expecting the spear.
He wasn't expecting the spear. And they got speared again.
Oh.
And then the commentary. It was so funny, the commentary. He's like, he could have broken a rib on that second spear.
And then why does Goldberg turn away from Brock and face the audience and make a thing? Like, what are you doing?
He's showboating.
Yeah, he's letting the audience know, look what the fuck I just did.
Plus, they got to kill time. They got like 28 minutes.
Why is Paul Heyman begging?
Because he's like, Paul Heyman is Goldberg, is Brock Lesnar's advocate.
I know.
He's going, please stop doing this, Goldberg. I had no idea it was going to be this bad, Goldberg. Please stop.
I just don't get what people...
Watch this. Watch this, like, Jim.
No one believes that Brock is that hurt, unless he hit him in diverticulitis.
No, it's Goldberg's spear.
Yeah, you got twice.
Exactly.
Do you like this finishing move or no?
The jackhammer? Yeah, it's fucking badass. Boom! That's it. Nobody gets up from that. And that was
a quick count.
Well, he's still down. You can count to 10 on that one, folks. He ain't getting up.
This did not instill a love of wrestling in me.
Well, I'll tell you this. Mark Hunt looks like a fucking horse's ass. You talk about a guy who couldn't get the job done. Goldberg got it done in a couple of minutes with three moves.
Yeah, Mark Hunt is none too pleased about what happened.
You
Mark Hunt
so?
Is very verbal about his displeasure with the UFC, yeah.
You think did Mark Hunt hear that the steroid test came back positive for...
I think word got back to him and he's suing them, yeah. Some shit going on.
Well, you know what?
Or he was planning on it.
Maybe if he had been as effective as Goldberg, he wouldn't have to sue his employer.
Yeah.
You know?
I don't know. I think he's been around for a while. He's just getting a little older, and he probably just, you know, it might have been his time to, you know, but come on, Mark. Mark didn't hit him as hard as he should have anyway.
How old is Mark? Yeah, he should have speared him. How old is Mark Hunt?
Don't know. He's probably over 40, I think.
Yeah, well, Goldberg's 49. 42. Two spears. Yeah.
42.
Mark Hunt's 42. Goldberg's 49. Two spears and a jackhammer, okay?
That should be the name of our radio show.
Spears?
Two spears and a jackhammer. And Travis is the jackhammer. And he just comes in with his hands going, duck, 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 duck. Like, that's his thing, like a jackhammer?
It should be two queers and a jackhammer, then.
I like that.
You do?
Yeah, and he fucks our asses. Travis comments.
Weird marketing.
Yeah.
It's really getting odd. Our audience.
We'll be back.
Ooh.
Yes, that's right.
Rockin' and rollin', rockin' and rollin'.
That's not even to the rhythm of the song. Welcome back. Jimmy's just smiling at me. It's Jim Norton and Sam Roberts. And look who we are joined by, Ben Bailey.
Hi, buddy. What's up, guys?
Welcome to the show, man.
How's it going? Thank you.
How are you?
I'm good. I'm cold. It's winter.
It
sucks, right?
God damn it.
Especially since
I was just going to stay warm all, you know, I'm like, I thought we were going to get away with it somehow.
But yeah, no, it was like 50 degrees winter. On Friday.
Yeah.
It was like nice. Everything was fine. Everything was fine.
50 mile an hour winds today.
Are you serious?
Yeah, they're going to be gusting. It was bad coming in yesterday. I flew home. I zipped back from the coast. I was in Florida. And it was a fucking... I always hate when you're flying in. They're like, the flight attendants are going to be seated. Like for the last 40 minutes of the flight, you're like, oh, this is going to suck.
Did it suck? Yeah. Was the landing bad?
Oh, it's the worst, right?
Yeah, it was really weird. I was like, I start getting nervous sometimes. Like I'm going to vomit. That's what I'm saying. I'm not scared of falling out of the sky anymore. I'm scared of vomiting.
Yeah.
I get to where, if I fly enough, I just get to where nothing bothers me at all on a flight. I'm just totally tuned out.
You don't care.
I had the worst landing. Like, I think it's very similar to what you're talking about. I didn't land yesterday, but I guess about a week ago. Just, we circled for 20 minutes where, you know, the plane's rocking back and forth. We're bouncing up and down. It's just horribly windy. And I was like, wow, I've been flying a lot. That just didn't bother me at all.
What do you do when you fly? You just sit there?
I was reading.
Yeah.
You don't get to just
ignore everything.
It just didn't bother me, man. But if like months go by and I don't fly, then I get on a flight, I'll be nervous.
Oh. You know?
I'll be like, dude, these things go down.
Was it a big plane or a little plane?
It was pretty big.
Okay, that's not as bad.
Big plane is much better, yeah.
Yeah. But that fucking circling, when you think you're coming in, and all of a sudden you're like, oh no, we're banking left. And left. We're making an oval. Oh, cunt.
We're going around again.
Oh, no.
Motherfucker.
We suck.
Oh, cunt.
So today,
that's what I always say.
Yeah, just my exclamation of choice. Sake.
Gosh darn it all.
Yeah, today's like the day that Donald Trump walks around and goes like, hey, do we still believe in global warming? Oh, it's pretty cold out, is it not? Yeah. It's his favorite joke.
I'm sure he'll mention that, yeah.
Of course he will. Of course he will.
He's handling things well on Twitter, though. I think that's good for the president-elect to be tweeting about Hamilton. Yeah. Jesus fucking Christ.
Inaccurately tweeting about Hamilton, right?
I was expecting...
Wasn't he saying the cast yelled at Pence, but they...
Or they berated him?
No, they just, like, spoke very kindly to him.
I thought they were very respectful. Yeah. I was expecting to hear him, like, really shit on.
Yeah.
And then I saw it, and the guy, they thanked him for coming, and they're basically expressing that they were nervous, and I didn't think they were nasty to him at all. They could have been much ruder.
Oh, yeah, the cast wasn't at all. The crowd booed him.
Crowd booed him.
But what are you going to do?
The cast told him don't boo.
Yeah, and the cast even intervened. So
they said no booing here. This is
Trump's
about
tweeting like he doesn't know what the fuck happened.
Yeah, I think he just heard that they said something, and
yeah,
he's
totally.
He tends to be reactionary.
But it's also this is what he writes.
Our what you tell him. So,
yeah, our wonderful future vice president. Wonderful.
Wonderful.
Mike Pence was harassed last night at the theater by the cast of Hamilton. Cameras blazing. This should not happen. And then I also believe that he said, yes, this is my favorite. The theater must always be a safe and special place. The cast of Hamilton was very rude last night to a very good man, Mike Pence. Apologize. Which is just to read a tweet where the number, like the non-PC candidate, right? Like the only reason he's in office is because he's not PC.
Yeah.
Is talking about how the theater should be a safe space.
Yeah, like, I don't believe that he ever once in his life felt that the theater was a safe and special
place. No, not at all.
You know, he never rolled over and just thought, oh, how I love theater.
Right. I feel unsafe today. Quick, get me to a play.
I feel so naked and alone.
The hallowed grounds of the Winter Garden. Yeah.
So
he's
foolish.
Seen cats more times than anybody.
Yeah, it was inaccurate. By the way, when you're the vice president and you're going somewhere, day up. It's sold out for 2 years, and you need a bunch of tickets in the third row. People say, well, he was just kind of going as a regular American. Then he wouldn't have gotten those fucking tickets.
Yeah, he wouldn't have gotten in, yeah.
How about this?
Oh, I didn't
with
know that service, part.
With secrets. So he called that afternoon.
Really?
How about this? When you're the vice president, or you're about to be the vice president, and you're known as a guy who kind of believes in the gay conversion camps.
Yes.
And is not the most gay-friendly politician of all time.
I don't believe it's for gay marriage either.
No, Nate's definitely not for gay marriage. Going to a Broadway show and being surprised that some of the cast has something to say to you, it would be weird if they didn't say anything to him.
Yeah,
I agree. I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, when you go there, you can't do a more homosexual thing than go to a Broadway play.
That's it.
It's the most homosexual thing you can do.
That's it.
You're basically in a vat of homosexuals. Don't be surprised when they're not happy to see you.
Yeah, when they know your stance.
When they know that you're anti-gay.
Right.
And I know that he did. They said, well, he signed that thing to protect the gay and lesbian people in Indiana. He did. But I think that was kind of, he was reluctant. But he did sign that one thing that protected protected them from discrimination when people are doing things in order in their religion. Like, you can't discriminate because of your religion against someone because they're gay. So he did sign that. He hasn't been, I think, completely horrible.
But he's a... He's
yeah, that's pretty good. I didn't know about that. I don't know much about the guy, honestly.
I know he's known as an enemy of the gay community.
Like, which is odd because he's so gay.
That's the only thing I really know about him.
Right,
yeah.
Right.
He looks like a guy who hates gay people so much they're going to find a murdered male prostitute in his trunk. Like, that's what he looks like. They're going to find one who's smothered with cigarette burns on him. You know, just his nipples bitten off. Mike Pence with a boner. I know he's a good man. I apologize, folks. I read the tweet.
Apologize.
I apologize. I'm
apologize
sorry.
Apologize now.
He implied that he fucks dead men. Say you're sorry. Sorry.
See... Here's the so the rumor, and this is from Snopes, is that Mike Pence supported gay conversion therapy, which involves the use of electroshock therapy. By the way,
right, they zap you until you're not gay anymore.
That comes
until you say, "Okay, I'm not gay anymore."
Fine, I'm not.
Just get
I'm not.
This fucking thing off my head.
Yeah, just bring me a pussy. Fine.
Yeah,
but when you have that statement and it comes back, it's a mixture. It's not true, but it's not false. Mike Pence once supported the use of federal funding to treat people seeking to change their sexual behavior.
No, hold on. Was that only for being gay? Because that's actually a good thing. If he's
that's
doing
what it's, I mean...
No, if it's treating their sexual behavior, like say you're sexually compulsive or you're cheating on your wife.
I think
or you're fucking different girls at work. Does he mean all of that stuff?
I'm sure it's religious-based.
Maybe.
Seeking to change their sexual behavior. That's just people who want to get laid.
Yeah, exactly. I'm not getting laid.
I'm just jerking off all the time.
Yeah, my asshole's
can
dry.
Can I get a government grant to help me?
I need to go to virgin conversion therapy.
That's the thing. Anything that you read, you could spin it around into, you know, absolutely
whatever you want.
Anything at all. Yeah.
Let's play what
Pence votes for federal funding for people who need to get laid.
But yeah. But he never said it. But he never said he supported the use of electric shocks or gay conversion therapy. Okay, so that's, there you go. It's false.
Let's
liar, Sam.
No, it's not.
Liar.
He definitely did. Let's
no, he didn't. He said it's false.
Let's hear what the cast said.
I'm gonna watch the video. Yeah.
Yeah, I didn't think that was particularly hateful, and like when
it
you're
wasn't.
Like when you're
no.
when you're Trump and you've said some inflammatory things and that's part of your appeal, when something like this happens, the best response would have been, the play was amazing, and I intend to be a president and a vice president for all Americans. Like, do you not know how to put out a fucking fire?
Right.
Jesus Christ.
Right. Yeah. You just go and go, like, you know, they're concerned. I get that they're concerned, and they will be satisfied, or they're going to be happy, or we are going to protect them. Or,
of course, we'll protect you. We'll look after you.
That's
none of that. You know.
But I hate that guy's dialect, though.
Well, he's doing it in a
Let
play.
Me tell you something, everybody. Like,
that's just how
he's talking. The sing-songy, like, nonsense of Hamilton.
But I didn't think that that was... That could have been really vicious.
It wasn't vicious.
And the crowd would have cheered. But that wasn't. And
yeah,
he told people...
Like
you don't hear it on that, but he did tell people, no, there's no booing here.
Yeah.
And he said, we hope we've inspired you. But people are nervous about it. And, a pro-life conservative vice president and a president who has said some... You know, some
for Mike Pence to come to
a
Broadway show in the middle of New York City, like obviously that's a thing. You have to say something. It would be, it would show a lack of integrity if the Hamilton people didn't.
Well,
say anything.
I like that they did it during the curtain call too. They didn't interrupt the show.
No, of
they didn't
not.
Change
yeah.
the show.
Yeah.
Yeah, and they told the crowd to stop booing him.
Right? Yeah, I disagree that was harsh.
Yeah, I don't think it was harsh at all.
Let's go
I
to Mark.
I think he got off easy.
Yeah.
I think we should try to get him back in there today.
Yeah.
And really let him
out. Go
it.
In there and watch Rent.
Mark in South Carolina, welcome to Jim Norton and Sam Roberts. Ben Bailey is here.
Well, good morning, gentlemen.
Hello.
Little Genie, I just wanted to say I loved you on Nightcap. You were amazing. I haven't heard you talk enough about that.
Thank you. I haven't seen it, so I haven't talked about it. Yeah, I did that.
What's Nightcap?
It's a show about a fictional talk show, about the booker of a fictional talk show, and I did, I think, the first episode, and that was with Gwyneth Paltrow, and I guess it aired, but I haven't seen
awesome.
It. Yeah, it was good. She was fun.
Yeah, especially when Gwyneth offered to give you a hand job. That was... I almost busted a nut myself.
Oh, yeah, she did. I a lot of that, we did the script, and then there was a few lines that were off that they actually kept in. I saw like a little one-minute teaser video and a couple of the improv lines they left in, but I haven't seen any of my stuff with her.
She was actually just asking you to give you a hand job?
And you forgot?
Yeah, we didn't know the cameras were rolling.
That's
Gwyneth
incredible.
Paltrow offered to give you a hand job and you forgot about it.
I forgot. There was certain.
I will never forget that.
That might have been
having
in the script.
Just heard it now.
But I saw a 1 minute teaser video that showed part of my stuff and part of everyone else's, but they didn't show any of my stuff with Gwyneth.
Yeah, but it was really good. It was the second episode of the new season.
Okay.
And it was very good. Anyway, going back to the original point that you guys were making, yeah, I agree with the way he said it was very polite and very nice. But I will agree with Stephen Van Zandt, Little Stevie from Bruce Springsteen's band, to where he said that was totally uncalled for because when someone goes to a play, they expect to be entertained, not spoken to, singled out, or lectured. And you know what? There's a time and a place for everything. The theater is supposed to be a safe place where you can actually relax and get into the performance and enjoy. And they made the spotlight turn on the vice
president. They did. Hold on. How about this?
That's not true.
How about the guy doesn't get the ticket seat? Like, when you're a conservative VP and you've taken that stance, you can't expect to get fucking 12 tickets in the middle of the room.
Plus, and the crowd had already booed him. It's not like the cast decided to just call him out.
And it was the end of the show.
They were addressing the situation, I think, and I thought they handled it well.
Well, they
literally had to stop him.
Also,
they literally had to stop him from leaving. Like, he was walking out because the show was over, and they were like, wait, before you go. And they said their thing.
No, I'm just kidding.
Yeah, he was walking out.
You leave, that's the thing, fuck you.
When he's leaving, that's a security reason that he's leaving before everyone else.
No, we understand.
Yeah,
we understand.
That's fine that he was leaving before everybody else. But the point
he
wasn't disturbed.
They also changed some of the lyrics poking at the administration. And that's the thing is, once it goes down, they were in, you know what? It wasn't Mike Pence that was going there that, oh, my God, I can't believe it was the vice president-elect. That's how he was able to get the tickets. Right. Now, Mike Pence, the person, you know what? If you want to go outside and debate him or talk to him, that's fine. But don't single him out. And the thing is, what happened when the cast came out there and gave their speech, that was the, I'm holier than thou, please listen, I have the forum, I'm going to put the spotlight on you and tell you exactly how you should be thinking.
You know what? Fuck Mike Pence. You're just convincing me that they did the right thing. Like, I know what you're saying, dude. And if they were really rude to... If they were really rude to that guy, if they said to him, your administration is garbage, I would be 100% with you. But after they said that, the bottom line is he's going to make decisions. This is not a guy who just said something politically incorrect. He's a man with power to make decisions over your life. It's a little different when you're a politician and you have the ability to affect people's lives by decisions you make and ways you vote and things you do. I have no problem with it after seeing it.
And as far as enjoying it,
agreed.
As far as enjoying it privately, like, he volunteered for the position to be the second biggest public figure in America, if not arguably one of the biggest public figures in the world. So it's going. You can't just sit
like
there.
You volunteered to take the morning show from Opie, really?
No.
Yes, we did volunteer to do this. Yes, sir. We're not victims. Yes.
If I was out and somebody was like, "Oh, you're Sam. You have a morning show. I know who you are. You don't know who I am, but I have an opinion about you." I wouldn't sit there and be like, "You don't have a right to have an opinion about me." I'd say, "Yeah, I've volunteered to put myself out there."
Yeah, we volunteered to this, sir. Exactly. You just made our point.
Business,
okay, so you would never. You never. When someone has a critical opinion of you, or you get pissed off, you hang up and say, "That's it. I've had enough."
There's times where you'll do that, but there's a difference. The difference is this, dude. The difference is,
way to go.
Here's the difference. I don't have the ability. Sam doesn't have the ability, Ben, to make decisions on your life. I haven't been passing legislation or fighting for legislation that's going to change Mark's life.
That's a huge difference.
Go ahead.
There's a difference, dude. When you're the Vice President of the United States, and there's also a different respect level that you should be spoken to. And I'm telling you, when I first clicked on that, I was expecting to be annoyed. Like, oh, great, these fucking liberal people just attacked the conservative. But then I saw the way they talked to him, and they were expressing concern, and will you be our... Like, they were basically saying for all of us, like, we're real here.
They said they were honored to have him there.
And after the stuff Trump has said, he has said some things that would cause concern if you're in one of those groups. Come on.
Absolutely. And they feel vulnerable.
And it's not hypocritical for Donald Trump to say, like, that should be a safe, sacred space.
Come
that
on,
should,
yes.
That shouldn't
it
happen.
It absolutely is, yeah.
Well, you confused me.
Yeah, we're not, dude, but I don't hate Mike Pence. I don't like him. I really don't love the guy because he's too conservative. And I don't think he deserves to be humiliated in public. But I think the administration, this is what's annoying me about this already. You have an opportunity to take that moment or with these protesters and go, I hear what you're afraid of. You don't have to be afraid. It's like, hey, dumb motherfucker, it's not always a win-loss.
Yeah,
you got the job.
Yeah. He definitely could have done something like that, and the whole everything would have been different.
Yes.
Everything we heard about would be different.
You can use that to your advantage. You go, Mike Pence can go, hey, they spoke their minds. I'm their vice president, and they spoke to me, and they were respectful. Like, what the fuck?
I think he should have stood up and broken into song himself. Just off the cuff.
Imagine if he just dropped really an N-bomb and walked out.
Yours!
Well, I think, I guess the thing is that bothers me is that they won the election. They got the Electoral College. That means the country has chosen them. You know what? They don't like his position. Well, then they should have got more people to vote the other way. It's a done deal.
They're not saying you shouldn't be the vice president. They're saying, just so you know, this is how we feel, and we want you to hear us.
And, dude, can't you just say,
you know, go ahead. And I'm sure that's the very first time he has ever heard that.
But again, aren't you? I guarantee you this: you like Trump and Mike Pence, right?
No, not really. Yes. So I was a Bernie guy.
Oh, okay. All right. So you don't think that he should have been talked to that way? Like you'd feel the same way even if it was Obama being spoken to by a play?
Absolutely, because the respectability of the office itself, not the person, the office itself.
Well, I don't think that they were particularly
disrespectful.
Yeah, I was expecting some. Maybe because I was expecting something different when I clicked on.
I totally was. I thought it was going to be like horrible.
Yeah,
like they're going to be like, "Boo! Well,
I agree, but it was
you don't care about us. Fuck you!" But
yeah,
they were like. They said they were honored to have him there, and they basically were just like, "We're worried, man. We're minorities. Yeah. We're worried about what's going to happen when your administration."
And there's a big difference.
Sorry, you got booed.
We're honored
to have you.
There's a big difference between like insulting people and shouting about it and saying this is wrong and saying you're not our president and da-da-da, and then seeing the guy face-to-face and saying, hey, no, none of that, none of the booing stuff, none of the insulting stuff, this is where we're coming from.
Yeah.
And I think that's what they were doing.
I thought they handled it well.
You know, whether you don't have to agree with them, but that's
And
just...
Pence wasn't offended.
No, he wasn't.
No, he was
not
fine with it.
He was not offended.
Because he's a guy who understands that that's what you do in that moment. Like, he's been in this game long enough to know that you come out of that saying, the play was great, and I heard what they say, and I wasn't offended.
Yeah.
Donald, on the other hand, picked up his Twitter account.
Yeah, he did.
Fuck Hamilton!
Somebody needs to take his phone away from him, man.
I like that he's honest, Trump. I like that he speaks his mind and says things that people don't like. But this is just
can't say he's
petty.
Not candid. Yeah,
it's petty, and it's wrong. It's reading it wrong. It's like, dude, you dumbbell. You got an opportunity now to fucking win people over who might have been annoyed with you.
Yeah,
like this is a gift. The fact that they're doing this is a fucking gift. If you're Trump and everyone's protesting you,
right?
And then the cast of the biggest play on the fucking planet comes out and says this, and you say you have nothing to be afraid of. We're going to be a great people would go like, oh, that's pretty
to
reasonable.
Bring everybody together,
right?
And instead, he reacted quickly without really seemingly knowing what happened, and you know, seemingly pushed people further apart.
And now the story is his tweet and not Mike Pence's response.
Exactly.
Yeah. Can we hear Pence's response? Actually, I'm going to hear Mike's response. Mike, like,
think,
I know him.
Do you
I wish
think
something
that
really
he...
funny queued up. Like Big Bird.
I want to hear what Mike says. What did Mike say when the play started talking to him?
Don't interrupt me, cunt!
I'm not disappointed. That was fantastic.
What was Trap Dog going to say?
You know, you say that now the story is about his tweet, but do you think that he is doing this consciously to get the Trump University stuff out of the picture? Because nobody's talking about that now.
Oh,
yeah, there was a lot of people suggesting that it was all you know, a smokescreen.
A ruse.
For the 74 remaining lawsuits.
Oh, there you go. Maybe, Travis. Might be.
I love that. But enough of that. Let's get back to this Hamilton thing.
Yeah, you might be right.
There were definitely people suggesting that on social media a lot.
That's right.
I would love to know, like, where Trump lands on that scale of like
probably about 260.
Yeah, it's getting and gaining.
Going up, quickly gaining.
I would love to know where he lands on that scale of nefarious versus impulsive. Like, is this just a guy who's impulsive, or is he a little more methodical than people give him credit for? Because I mean, that's the question, right? Like, it's a pretty impulsive, kind of angry and irrational thing to do, to just throw this tweet out and say, fuck you, I love Mike Pence. But it's pretty methodical and well thought out to be like, oh, this will be a good story to distract people.
I honestly don't think that he's thinking about it that much.
Right.
I don't think he's worried about the stuff. I think he's just like...
He's pretty sure he's going to win anyway.
He's just like, yeah, he couldn't... His belief that he can do no wrong is like ironclad right now.
Right.
So he's just... I think he honestly just reacted.
Yeah. Why would
What do you mean they booed Pence? Fuck them. I'm going to tweet about it right now.
I think you're right.
Several advisors like, no, Mr. Trump, let's think about this. Oh, fuck off. Leave me alone.
I really want Trump to be different than everyone. Like, you know what I mean? Like, I'm not anti-Trump at all. Like, I really want him to do well. Like, I want him to be like a surprise. Like, oh my God, we thought he was going to be terrible, and he's not. Like, you know, a lot of people.
I do too. I totally agree with you, Jimmy.
I just wish he would stop with the Twitter. That's all that's bothered me so far. Not his fucking choice. Just stop tweeting.
Stop tweeting.
Twitter stinks.
Right.
He stinks at Twitter.
He needs social media help.
You're the leader of the free world. Or at least say it differently. Not Melania and Mrs. O had a great time! Exclamation point. What the fuck you doing,
Mrs.
O? I'm a guy who's defended you for a year. And I'm saying stop. Stop tweeting. Your Twitter stinks.
I had high hopes too. I thought it was like maybe he'll get in and he'll really want to bring about this all this change that he's talking about,
like,
that people really want. Like, I feel like if Bernie had won the Democratic nomination, he might be our president right now.
Very well. And if Joe Biden had run, I think he would definitely
Biden would
be
have
our
won,
president.
But Bernie would. I don't think Bernie would have beaten
Bernie
Trump.
Would have,
no.
I just feel like people wanted change so badly. That's why.
You know, I don't know about Bernie, because they were saying like
burn baby.
Okay, thanks.
Feel the burn.
They were saying statistically that like a lot of Obama vote people who voted for Obama. There was a surprising number of them that ended up voting for Trump. And I think that does go to the change thing that people wanted. So who knows? Maybe all those people who voted for Obama would have voted for Bernie instead of Trump.
Right.
Right. And then all the Hillary people would have voted for Bernie.
Is that what you think?
Yes, exactly. So then it would have been Bernie.
Right. Yeah. Possibly.
Travis is laughing at me. Why are you laughing, Travis?
How confidently you push that iPad with no sound coming out.
Not a lick, huh?
Not a lick. Well, I guess they showed me.
You're not so smart now, are you?
Fuck me.
What, did you give it a tap instead of a press or a push?
Whatever I did, I've gotten more fucking response tapping my windows at home. Nothing happened.
Do you want to...
You got a whole bag of tricks over there, huh?
I want to hear Mike's response.
You want to hear Mike?
Yes.
Oh, Mike's response?
I want to hear...
He's got a verbal response?
Yeah, and I think that should be more the story.
A minute left, and I got to ask you about the subject everybody is talking about today. You know what it is, and that is the fact that you went to see the Broadway musical Hamilton on Friday night. And afterwards, the cast addressed you as you were walking out of the theater about their concerns as to whether Mr. Trump will protect diversity in our nation. Here he is.
We truly hope that this show has inspired you to uphold our American values and to work on behalf of all of us.
Now, Saturday morning, Mr. Trump tweeted this. The cast of Hamilton was very rude last night to a very good man, Mike Pence, apologized, and he tweeted about it again.
None of that is true.
At 6:23 this morning. Governor, what did you think of the cast comments, and did you consider it rude?
Well, first off, my daughter and I and her cousins really enjoyed the show. Hamilton is just an incredible production and incredibly talented people. And it was a real joy to be there. And, you know, when we arrived, we heard a few boos and we heard some cheers. And I
nudged
my kids and reminded them that's what freedom sounds like. But at the end,
Pause that for a second. Here's what happened. It was just boos. And then he sarcastically said, I guess that's what freedom sounds like. And he said he's shifting this to now there's cheers and boos.
The cheers were coming from the cousins. But yeah,
that's what freedom sounds like. Who wrote that?
This is kind of the way you got to take that. You know, it's like,
yes, of course.
People are going to like you, they're going to hate you.
Of course.
Yeah, that's a good point.
Of course, go ahead.
From the stage, and I can tell you, I wasn't offended by what was said. I'll leave to others whether that was the appropriate venue to say it, but I do want to say that the basic element, the center of that message is one that I want to address, and that is I know this is a very disappointing time for people that did not see their candidate win in this national election. I know this is a very time for some people. And I just want to reassure people that what President-elect Donald Trump said on election night, he absolutely meant from the bottom of his heart. He is preparing to be the president.
That's exactly how you respond.
All of the people of the United States of America. And to watch him bringing together people of diverse views, bringing together people that differed with him strongly, seeing him talk to leaders around the world, I just want to reassure every American that in the days ahead, I'm very confident that they're going to see President-elect Donald Trump be a president for all of the people, and we embrace that principle, and we're going to work hard to make that principle so every day that we serve.
That's a great response, and that should have been the story. That should have been the story that Trump tweeted instead of the reaction is so stupid.
Yeah, beginning, middle, and end of it right there.
Yeah.
Like, that's it.
Well handled.
Yeah. Whether it's bullshit
Pence
or not.
Pence just did what you were suggesting.
Great job. Yeah,
exactly.
I have not seen that clip.
Done.
Yeah, he did it right.
Here's an opportunity to reach out to these people and tell them it's all right.
And I guess that's where a seasoned politician does kind of work, or guy knows, like, this is how you handle it, as opposed to...
But it's not even like a seasoned politician. It's just like, you have just watched politicians for the years that you've been alive, and you're aware enough to know that that would be how one responds.
And I'm a seasoned man.
You're a seasoned man. Yeah.
Well, I don't know.
Yeah.
You smell seasoned.
Thank you.
Yeah, what does that mean?
Just, I'm a man of seasons.
Seasoned man. Yes. I just wish it was the winter of your life if you were a seasoned man.
Wait, that would mean I'm going to die soon.
That's right.
Oh, okay.
That's it.
Understandable.
That's right.
It's an understandable feeling. I'm sure there's many that are the same. But how mad did that last call get? So did you guys plan when you took the morning show from over? Shut up. Oh, is that your atomic bomb? Fucking idiot.
Well, how do we respond to that?
Oh, no. Hang up. Shut your face.
Dump.
He just got mad.
He did.
He was just lashing out.
He got upset.
He really wanted us to agree with him.
Yeah. Wasn't going to happen, though.
More than we did.
Yeah. Wasn't going to happen. Ben Bailey.
What's up, man?
You've got a new special.
I do, yeah.
That's available now on therealbenbailey.com or on iTunes.
Yep, or Amazon, or, you know, it's kind of all over the place.
Yeah.
Best Buy, all that stuff.
You didn't go with a network at all?
No, I didn't. I produced it myself.
That's awesome.
And thanks, man. And I wasn't totally sure what to do with it, and I'm not great at the selling part of anything. Yeah. And then I was like, you know what, my website really needs to be overhauled, and everything's changed since I put it up years ago, and... So I was like, you know what, I'm just going to put it up on my... So basically, it's on my site along with a whole bunch of other stuff, and that's pretty much it, man.
So it's like a good reason to redesign your website. Let me put a special up there, and then I can get a nice website redesign.
Yeah, well, I needed to redo it anyway, and I just... It feels like now you can just create your own content and put it straight out, so that's what I'm doing.
And you got two podcasts, too. Tall But True with Colin as your first guest, and Speaking of Movies with Emma Gleason. All right, so you're like, you haven't been like that social media active doing this stuff, and now you're just like, fuck it, I'm going to do it?
Yeah, totally. I Cash Cab came and went for me. And
what years was that?
That was 05 to 12.
That was 7 years?
We did it for 8 years. So from 2004 to 2012.
Real nice run.
Oh, thanks. Yeah, it was great. But everything changed. Like, before Cash Cab, there was no Twitter.
That's right.
There was no, like, people were not big into social media, like, and then it ended, and I was like, oh my God, everything's changed.
Yeah,
everybody has a show.
Yeah,
their own show, and I was reluctant. I was like, I don't know what to do. And then I don't know, after a few years of trying to pitch things, trying to land something, I was like, why am I still trying to sell my stuff?
Right,
why don't I just go ahead and make it and create it and see what comes from that?
Right.
Now I can get it right out to the people who actually want to see it. And so that's what I've done. The last few years, I've been working hard on getting the podcast ideas straightened out. I didn't want to just do something just to do something. I wanted to wait till I was inspired.
Right.
Jimmy, maybe you remember DC, Benny and I used to do that show, Urban Myth. It was like a storytelling show.
Oh, right,
Tuesday nights.
I do remember that.
Years ago.
Yes.
It was like, we did it every Tuesday for like 5 years, and it was, everybody came through. It was great. So that's basically what Tall But True is. It's just a storytelling show.
Oh, okay.
It's like the two of us co-host, and then we have a guest come in and tell
us. Are you still in the Sabbath cover band?
Yes, I am, yeah. we haven't played in a while because I've been so busy with this other stuff, but yeah, definitely.
I love that Ben, who asked me about Sabbath. How many years ago is that? I started bringing you Sabbath CDs.
Like, it's got to be 6-7 years ago.
That's one of my greatest accomplishments as a man, is that I got Ben Bailey in a Black Sabbath.
Dude, I went to a bachelor party down in Atlantic City, and the only guy that brought music brought all Sabbath. And for the first couple hours, I was like, all right, enough of this fucking Sabbath, man. We get it. You like Sabbath. And like 2 hours later, I was like, these guys are fucking amazing. Holy shit. Just totally turned. And then I literally didn't listen to anything but Sabbath for like 3 straight years.
Yeah.
Nothing but. And that's what I was all over you, because I knew you were a huge fan.
Yeah, what do you recommend as a CD? And I'm like, all right. I just started handing over CDs and giving them away.
Jimmy bought them and brought them to me.
Oh, yeah, I did.
At the cellar. He brought me a whole stack of them. He's like, here's what you should start with.
Can you imagine having a band like that that still picks up new fans? You know what I mean? That somebody discover a Black Sabbath and become obsessed with them for 3 years.
I'm just happy to be on a radio show that picks up new fans.
Imagine that, man. That's
unbelievable.
Those guys are in their 70s, right? And they're plus they had 13 was like their biggest album ever in the US.
Yeah, I loved it.
Yeah, it's so good. I'm really just getting into it now. Like I didn't want to listen to it that much.
I was like
I want to stay with the old stuff. I can't do it, but I did a bunch of Air Force bases through October, domestic bases. I did like 12 of them. And I just had it in my phone, so I just listened to
13. Oh, you're doing stand-up?
Yeah. And, man, I really got into it, man. Damaged Soul is fucking amazing.
It's my favorite fucking thing ever.
Great song,
my favorite thing ever. And that was one I asked Ozzy about. Rick Rubin just said that was a warm-up thing they were doing. There's a song there called Damaged Soul, and that was just a riff they were playing in warm-up, and Rick Rubin said, got to do something with that. And that's why Ozzy's like, I have the lyrics. I don't love the lyrics in that, because it was a very last-minute song supposed to be on the album.
It's the best song on the album.
That's interesting.
Yeah, it was just like they would do these warm-up riffs, and Rick Rubin just knew it was good.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's where Rick comes in handy.
He does.
So good.
He's pretty good, yeah.
He's got a good ear.
Yeah. Yeah, he's okay at that sort of thing.
He's not bad at all. And they were talking, you were talking before Ben came in about his performance years back at the Patrice O'Neill roast.
Mm.
Yeah, I read something about that recently. People just
really?
Still love that. Yeah, they'll still go and find that song. I don't even know where it's up.
Yeah, I don't know where it is either, but I've gotten like a fair amount of social media and stuff. People tweet about it and talk about it. That was like one of my... That was a big night for me, man. That was like, you guys didn't see me coming, I don't think.
No, nobody knew you were that good at roasts. Yeah.
Yeah, and I was nervous about it, so I really wrote. Like, I think if you're going to do a roast, you really have to write about it. You can't just go in and, you know, you can make it look off the cuff maybe, but.
You can't just wing it.
You can't just wing it.
Research and write a bunch of jokes and, yeah.
Yeah, not with this group. You know, the guys that were on that one.
You murdered everyone. You murdered everyone. That was really funny.
Yeah. I listened to a little bit of it. I was like, holy shit, did I fucking say that? Like, I can't believe I said that. It's so mean.
I never, I think Musavia had that audio or whatever. Where was that from? No, he had the Jim Norton roast. I don't know who had that one.
That was a great roast, too.
At Caroline's,
that was awesome.
Yeah.
That was harsh, man. Some things were harsh on that one.
Who was on that? You, Colin, Geraldo, Bob Levy. Who else was on that?
Bob Levy. Nick was on it.
Oh, Patrice was on it.
Patrice.
Nick.
Florentine.
Florentine.
Yeah, that was a great night, man. Musavia recorded that with like, he had like a 4-camera shoot going. Patrice's, that is.
Back to
Patrice's
a video?
Roast, yeah.
Oh.
But that's never been out. Just the audio has been released.
That's weird.
Yeah.
They would go to the trouble of shooting it like that and then just not doing
anything. I didn't remember there was 4 cameras.
Yeah. Huh. They showed it at the stand one night.
Did people like it?
Yeah, I guess. But nobody knew about it. I you know, I didn't know about it.
It's one of those lost tapes.
Well, it's not lost if he has it.
I mean, I got back to the audience.
Found.
I guess.
Lost.
Yeah.
Found tapes. Lost and found.
Yeah, we did it all.
Lost and found.
We did it all right here.
That clip looks like it's from your roast, Jimmy. Is that Bill? It says Bill Burr at Patrice O'Neill, but that's Caroline's.
Bill was on that one? Yeah, fuck, man.
Was Bill on it? He was on the other one. He was on Patrice's, I know.
I think he was probably on both.
It's amazing, like, what's happened with everybody since then.
Yeah,
you know, I remember just looking at the dais and being like, wow.
In 2000, we did the Barry Katz roast.
Yeah.
And I remember Louis, I think Jeff Ross hosted it. I remember Louis coming on just being so fucking mean.
Oh my God. He just hammered
just mean.
Ross. He goes, how are you successful with those poems? What the fuck?
He was just mean.
He
wasn't even kidding.
He just pounded Ross.
Yeah, he was just saying things that were mean. Yeah. I think he was mean to Barry.
I forgot about that.
And you suck as a manager. Like, I forget what he said. It's been 15 years, but
he just decided to be mean.
It was very unpleasant.
That's great.
Oh, there, look at this. They're all up there.
Yeah, I think you can find video of that if you Google
it. Is that? Oh my God,
Patrice on the Barry.
Oh my God, there is video of this. Oh yeah, Maya, she shot this. Look at dumb
Maya
Voss.
Filmed it.
Voss. Oh, that's amazing.
This is the old Boston Comedy Club.
I just saw Voss yesterday. He's wearing that same suit.
Wow. It's
like
weird.
14 years ago.
Oh, my God. I've never seen this.
No, I haven't either. Jeez, that's
crazy,
man.
Do you want to listen to it?
No,
yeah, I didn't really either.
I can't watch
that. Wow. Man.
That's rough.
Crazy.
It's rough, man. I still feel like some of the... Just like all of a sudden, people we knew just started fucking...
You get old, they drop dead.
Dying. It's like, fucking awful. What the fuck is going on?
Yeah. Awful.
Well, you don't think about it, and it sort of feels like there's maybe still they're just out on the road or something.
Yeah, then you're
right. You don't see everybody else anymore as
no.
much.
You're used to not seeing people.
That. Yeah.
You're like, oh, yeah, I haven't seen so-and-so in 5 months. But then you're like, oh, yeah, he's dead. That's why.
That's fucked.
That's so
brutal. People are rooting for me to see him soon. And I talk about Patrice a lot on stage. There's an incident that he and I had. It was a fun moment in Brazil that I mentioned on stage. So it's not like he's been out of my mind.
Right.
But then you see something that you haven't seen in years. You're like, ugh.
Yeah. You say that with such cheer. It sounds like it might not involve young hookers.
Oh, no, it did.
A special moment in Brazil that
yeah,
we
it
had.
It was a very
like
fun
a
moment.
Like a family Christmas, the yeah, way you said it.
Oh, I was wearing my Charles Haley jersey in this one.
Looks so cool. Yeah. One thing about you, like, jerseys always agree with you because you have such a natural athletic build.
It's funny you say that. A lot of people don't think that.
You know, well, just because you're not wearing shoulder pads. But other than that, it looks like...
Jimmy's in good shape these days, though.
These days, not those days.
Back then.
Yeah, I had more hair
different.
Back then, darker hair.
Yeah, more chins.
Yeah, I was a fatter boy.
One extra
juicy
one extra
lower
layer.
Lip. Jesus Christ, no wonder Cox loved me. Look at that juicy lower lip.
Look at the way, though, like you have that chin there, but look at the way your cheeks just blend to your neck.
Yeah, they do.
I've never seen anything
it
like that.
Just roll
before.
Right in there.
No,
yeah,
I used to say
just in the middle on the sides, right. Not by the ears. There's, you can see
yeah,
there's.
I've
like
commented
jawline.
On that a lot, yeah.
Have you?
I look like a fleshy celery stalk. Yeah, that was awful.
It's like somebody just took the Photoshop blur tool and put it on the sides of your mouth right
That's
there.
That's very hurtful. Well, I'm tearing. I got 528 views on that puppy.
Whoa!
Light
well,
ups.
And Jim, right. It's only been up for.
Making money, man.
It's only been up for 2 years.
Absolutely.
So this is only the beginning.
There you go. Had a boy.
Thumbs up.
Had a boy, Jimbo.
Two thumbs up. Jimbo.
Yeah, 2-0 right now as far as reviewers go.
Oh, boy.
Well,
boy.
Ah, boy, tearing that shit up. I haven't seen that in so long. I mean, I'm almost embarrassed to see what's on. I haven't watched it in years.
Oh, man, I'm afraid to, like, look or at her, old stand-up.
I don't think I've heard that since it's been out. Maybe I've heard it in the years since, but I don't remember.
Yeah.
I can't remember it.
We should take a break.
Oh.
We have Gary Busey coming in here.
Okay. No way. Gary Busey's coming in.
That's right. But Ben Bailey, we can get your special at therealbenbailey.com. We can follow you at Real Ben Bailey. You can also get the special on iTunes and Amazon. It's called Ben Bailey, Live and Uncensored. And if you wanna sample it, right, mm-hmm. then download the podcast. You just started two new podcasts called Tall But True. And another one called Speaking of Movies.
And yep, Ben yep. is a really funny stand-up, and thanks, you know, Jimmy. It's hard for you to say that, but I mean, as a comic, I mean, you're a really good act.
Thanks,
and if you want to check out Ben's special and then check out live dates, he's got dates in Peoria, Illinois, which is Richard Pryor's hometown, The Connection in Rhode mm-hmm. Island, and he's got a couple of different places in Michigan. So go to The Real BenBailey.com to get his dates. Ben's a really funny act.
Yes.
Thanks, Jim.
And I'm happy to see you, buddy.
Thanks
for having
man.
Me, guys. Yeah, good to
so
see
we'll
you.
So we'll see
yeah,
you again
sure.
soon, okay?
All right, absolutely.
And we'll be back with Gary Busey right after this. Oh, Alabama Shakes, huh? Welcome back to Jim Norton and Sam Roberts. Jim Norton is, as they say, draining the lizard. That's right. That's what they say, right, Travis?
Nobody says that.
Oh. No, he's dropping a hot tinks. He's back now, though.
I don't think that's one either.
What? He was just dropping a hot tinks.
Nobody says dropping a hot tinks.
That's when somebody's peeing.
Yeah, I was tinking my brains out.
See? I try to tell you, Travis.
Yeah, why?
You're very behind the time. He said nobody says dropping a hot tinks.
So you're out of your mind.
Crazy.
Everyone says it.
Everybody says it.
It's just, I guess, from becoming a father and getting married, I'm just out of the whole
thing. You are.
Yeah.
You're in the bubble.
Yep.
Yeah.
The no tinks bubble.
Yeah. I was, sitting there fucking,
ew.
Tanking up a hot storm.
Oh.
As they say.
That's right.
Everything goes when it comes to hose, but tinking ain't easy.
You knew it tinks up a hot storm.
Okay. I have to tweet something. I get a response from Colin Quinn. I did a really cute video.
Oh, boy.
You try to tribute. What a fucking dick Colin is. I try to tribute. Look, he did a special.
Yes,
for Netflix.
It's on right now. The New York Story is streaming on Netflix.
Yeah, it is. And I get a response for, as a good person,
yeah.
I tweet a gift to Colin in honor of his thing. That's me in the store.
Okay, Jim is just bopping his head and smiling to this song. What does this have to do with Colin? Singing along.
He's not a fan of that tune.
Oh, you wrote on the Twitter, a gift for a Colin Quinn in honor of his successful Netflix special. Yeah. What a terrible gift.
Hold on, yes.
So that was last night, I guess.
Yeah.
And you decide, and he responded to that?
He did.
What did he write?
Let me, hold on.
Let's see, we might be able to get it here.
It was, not as positive as I had hoped. He writes, good choice for song, asshole. Tell her about it is stuck in my head all morning on my radio tour. It's making me sick.
So he's just calling up every radio station going,
oh, I'm so happy. He's just one of the worst Billy Joel songs ever.
Biting his knuckle and humming, tell me about it. Well,
I used to like that song, but then he pointed out the bad line about tell her all your crazy dreams, and it really ruined it for me.
It's a bad song. It's not a good song.
You don't like it?
No. Nope. No, it isn't.
I think you're wrong. Tell her all your crazy dreams.
Okay, it doesn't sound like that.
I'm good.
Not as far as that song goes. We have Gary Busey. Do we know where he is?
He's on his way up.
He is. He moves a little slowly.
Well, plus, it's a tough time to get up in the building.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. Just Jim making timely observation.
I didn't know there was a period there.
No, there is, because I mean, now the elevators, this new system is crazy.
Yeah, it's terrible.
Did you think to yourself, well, that was an uninteresting sentence. There must be something after this.
I was expecting more.
Yeah. Well,
it was only a follow. It wasn't meant to be captivating.
It wasn't?
Someone said Gary Busey's on his way up, and like, because he is a little bit late, so I was pointing out that's the reason. It's a tough time to get in the building.
Oh, I'm glad you repeated it.
Yeah. I'm going to say it four more times.
Get that information out
there. As a matter of fact.
Yeah, tell him about it.
Yeah, I'm going to tell him about it.
He's coming in.
Cool.
Yeah.
Hey, Gary. That's not Gary.
No, that's Spencer.
Tough time to get in the building.
Yeah, that's right. Okay. That was number three, right?
No, that was number two.
That was two.
I've only done two because that was a warm-up for three.
I see. Okay. So you've done it twice.
Yep.
And
third time coming.
We have let our talent booker, Spencer, know that we're ready for Gary Busey.
Yeah, tell him Gary Busey.
How you say his name?
Gory. Hi, Gory. Gory Busey.
He's coming in. He's got a play here in New York called Perfect Crime,
allegedly,
which is now through December 4th at Times Square's Theater Center. It's the theater in Times Square. I think it's right under the Snapple sign. Right. Let's see. There he is.
Yeah, right here, sir.
Jim?
Hello.
Hey,
good to see you, guy.
Have you got your shirt?
Gary.
What's that?
Last time I saw you, I said you got to get a shirt that says Sperm Farmer on it.
Oh, my God, yes. He did tell me last time to get a shirt that says Sperm Farmer. No, I haven't, but I've used my mouth as one.
Your mouth doesn't count because the only thing that comes out of that is bad spit.
That's absolutely correct.
That's right.
I'm glad
everything
you
else.
Made it in. It's a tough time to get in the building because the elevator system is messed up. Come on, Adrian. I'm sorry. You're knocking Gary over.
Would you help him out a little bit? Jesus, Adrian.
No, he's terrible at his job.
No, he hasn't. Adrian!
Let me get seated first. Sorry. He doesn't know what to do.
You're about the family in Arkansas.
Adrian, now put the mic by his mouth so we can hear.
Poor.
Tell me.
He couldn't meet the poverty level.
Yeah.
In order to make ends meet, they had to jack the dog off into a bag to feed the cat.
No, I didn't hear that.
I've not heard that. No.
You're in the family, buddy.
I should be. I pretended I was the cat.
No, you're the number one dog jacker in Arkansas.
Fair enough.
Had it not been for radio, Jim.
Oh, you guys are in here.
Had it not been.
Yeah.
Okay. I just saw my wife's eyes, Stephanie, look at me, and that's a joke I should never have told, so we'll dismiss that. Edit it.
We'll cut that. It was stricken from the record.
That will never happen again.
You don't have to worry about that. Well, welcome, Gary Busey, to Jim Norton and Sam Roberts. It's been a while.
Yeah.
Last time you were up here, you were talking to us all about the, what are the words that have initials for things? Like your fart was
called Buseyisms.
Buseyisms. Yeah, you're telling us all about the Buseyisms last time you were here.
Yeah, and I don't do it with proper names, but I did one with Trump when I was doing Celebrity Apprentice. Mm-hmm. And T-R-U-M-P stands for Taking Redirection Understanding Massive Power.
That's right.
And it's accurate, too.
Yeah, that does. It works for now, too.
Tell us sober.
Sober. Sober is a good word. That's sober. What we all need to know. S-O-B-E-R
right.
stands for son of a bitch. Everything's real.
Hey, Jim, you're a sober guy. Is that right?
Travis in there always said sober means slow on booze, enjoy the road. But I was like, that never stinks,
that.
Travis.
That sucks.
That's not
Travis, Travis, Garrett? we're going to get you to see Dr. Phil quick.
Yeah. Yeah. Have you seen, have you done Dr. Phil's show before?
No.
You wouldn't do it, right?
Oh, yeah.
You would?
Of course you would.
I've got lots of things wrong with me, but they're all good. They're all good. I'm a good guy.
What's wrong with you that's good? What's something that you think is wrong with you but works in your favor?
Right.
Just breathing.
Breathing? Okay, breathing is actually right, though.
No, breathing is right.
Yeah.
It's never wrong. Ask me that question again.
Okay. What do you said there's a lot wrong with you that works, but what do you think is something that's wrong with you that actually is good?
Everything. Everything I do wrong, I'm able to give it a good silver lining, mm-hmm. and create a positive influence in it, and the wrongness becomes a goodness because the goodness is better than the wrongness, but it's the wrongness that promotes, inspires, and motivates the goodness. So wrongness and goodness are the same thing. They're just different colors.
Do you get that?
No, but I think he's very hard to argue with.
Yeah, yeah.
No,
it's very well thought out.
All right, you win.
I can argue with him.
You can argue with him? You understand that? Okay.
So wrongness, and as long as it's...
Do you usually talk like that? So.
Well, I'm trying to gather what you're saying.
You said I'm trying to gather. I love this echo stuff. We're in an echo. Whoa.
Yeah, please. I'm tired of the same
hey,
shit.
Hey.
He does that. He just makes these little womanly noises. I don't like it either.
You guys still living together?
No, we separated. We were seeing other people.
What happened?
Yeah.
He was having trouble maintaining an erection.
For Jim. Which I'm sure you can understand.
You don't need a big one with this dude.
No, you don't.
Just little, what do you call them? Wiener sausages or what?
That's a cocktail,
little hot dog, Frank.
Yeah.
Let's get off that. We
yeah,
don't
please.
Want to talk about wieners.
No, that's
no,
ridiculous.
Not at all.
That's ridiculous.
His family's back there.
What's going on?
Are you guys having fun with this show? Because you're so good at it.
We love
it.
I mean, I'm so proud and happy and honored to be here with you two clowns.
Well, thank you.
By the way, I want to take the words that spell clown and give you abuseism.
C-L-O-W-N. Yeah.
It stands for creates laughter on Wednesday nights.
We aren't on at night, but the replay is. That is something. Our replay comes on.
Clown.
On Wednesday nights, so we are a couple clowns. Does your family like the Buseyisms? It seems like, you know, it's fun for us because we see every couple years maybe, but it could get old very, very quickly.
Yeah,
it doesn't get old.
I would gather it might.
No, or do you change them?
Well, that's your unlimited way of thinking now.
Yeah. Right.
But you get the Buseyism book, and you read it, and you read, open it to any page you want to, mm-hmm. and you'll see a word like simple.
Right.
Simple. What does that mean?
Well, I know what that means. It's easy, right?
What?
Simple? It means like easy.
No. Oh. That's one way to define it,
That's a simple way of looking at it.
That's a simple way of
looking
at it.
What's simple mean?
S-I-M-P-L-E stands for see it manifesting. Precious loving energy.
That's what simple means, to manifest energy?
If you learn that with your significant other, now that it's not this dude.
Right, unfortunately.
You'll get to third base quick.
You think that's all it takes?
No, I don't know. That's not all it takes. It's how you talk, make a woman laugh. You look at her like you're her number one servant. Mm-hmm. You're her number one fan. Mm-hmm. You love her like the angels love the church. And everything will go right with you. And the best way to make it right with a woman,
right,
no matter what it is, mm-hmm. just agree with her.
Yeah. Now, that's got to be tough for you, though, right? Because,
No.
Because, so you're not an arguer, you'll agree.
No.
You're adored everywhere you go. So how can you look at a woman as if I'm your number one fan, where everywhere you're going, they're Gary Busey fans?
I'm talking about my soulmate for 32 lifetimes, Stephanie mm-hmm. Irene Sampson Busey.
Right.
And she is what I call my angel with a whip.
With a whip?
Yeah.
That's exciting.
You don't see that thing coming. It'll pop your ear off in a second.
Yeah?
So you'll lose arguments at home.
I don't lose them. I just change them to make sure I can win in the end.
How's that?
It's easy.
Yeah?
Just use your eyes and use your smile mm-hmm. and use the warmth of your skin to make sure your palms aren't sweaty.
Right. So just about being charming, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, that makes sense to me.
Yeah, that makes sense to me, too.
Are you mocking my voice?
Yes, he is.
No. Gary had to go to the bathroom. My name is Schmeck, and I'm a little guy, but I have an education.
Oh, I see. Where did you get your education?
Everywhere I go.
Oh, so you're more like a street-educated little person.
Yeah.
I see.
Yeah.
How old are you?
Hey, Schmeck, get out here.
Oh.
Okay, I gotta go.
Okay, Smeck's leaving.
Oh. Sorry about that, guys.
That's all right. I get it. I understand.
Chip's here.
Fucking Smeck.
How much fun do you guys have during the show?
We are having a lot of fun.
It's great.
We're having a lot of fun.
Well, you got to make fun happen when it ain't happening, right?
That's it.
Okay, that's the key element to success.
Right.
Making fun happen when it's not happening.
Is that a euphemism? Is that a Garyism? Or
abuseism for the word fun, F-U-N, is finally understanding nothing.
Right. Right.
Well, now, do you make fun, though, when other people think, like, hey, man, this isn't a time to have fun? Will you wind up trying to make something fun and other people get annoyed at you for
like
that?
Inappropriate
times? I'm not going to annoy anybody because I'm laughing with hysterically inside.
Inside, not outwardly.
Yeah.
I see.
So they can sense that your intentions are good.
My intentions are always good.
Yeah.
Even if people don't think my intentions good, it's because they're not thinking about themselves righteously.
It's on them. Okay.
Yeah. It's never on you, then.
It's never on me. Yeah, it's always on me.
What?
It's always on me.
But you said it's on them for not being righteous.
No, tonight when we go out to dinner, dinner's on me.
Gotcha.
Oh, nice.
Gotcha. You got it. You got the checkbook. No problem. Yeah, got that Buddy Holly money. Yeah. No problem.
All right.
Hey, Norton and Roberts, you know, that's a pretty good name for a law firm that works on bent fenders.
You think so? Think we're a couple of ambulance chasers?
Yeah, that's the ticket, yeah.
Oh, Gary's really giving us a beating this morning.
He really is. So, Gary, what? You're in a play.
I'm in what?
Your play. It starts tonight, right?
I'm not on a plane. I'm sitting in a radio station.
No, I didn't say plane. I said play. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm in a play, and the beautiful thing about this play is that it has the Guinness Book of Records of the longest running play in New York. And it's been running. It's been running for 30 years. And Kathleen Russell has been in the play 30 years. And I'm a brand new guy in the play. But I started out in my younger years doing plays. So I love them. I know them. And it's just so much fun to do.
When you go into a play that has that much history, you worry about fucking it up at all?
No. If you worry, whatever you worry about is going to happen.
Oh.
Because the word worry, W-O-R-R-Y, stands for working on ridiculous routines yearly.
I see. And you don't do that.
No, there's no time for that.
No.
So you don't panic that you're going to... Is it hard to do in front of a live audience after all these years just doing films?
No, that's better, man. Because you got the live audience out there feeding off your energy. You're feeding off them. And it's just like a spiral swirl of amplification in every direction your artistic being can make it.
You seem to have a good memory, though. Like, you know, for you to remember the sperm farmer shirt, I didn't remember that. So you seem to have, like, a pretty good
really
recall
good
ability. So for you, dialogue must not be a problem.
Are you aware that you did have a traumatic brain injury?
No.
You didn't know that,
I didn't know
did
that,
you?
No.
No, it happened in the 60s.
What happened?
You were on a tricycle.
You fell off your tricycle in the 60s. You know what?
He fell off his tricycle into a fire hydrant.
No, it was the 70s, and I fell off my tricycle onto a dick.
You know,
that got a little blue, didn't it?
You know what's funny about you guys?
Right.
Nobody hears the punchline of your joke, but you guys are laughing like farm animals.
We're having a good time.
Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah, that's the point.
Well, as long as you can't have a good time, get out.
We're having
fun. Right. As long as we're finally understanding nothing, we're good.
That's all that matters.
You know what that is?
Yeah, fun. No, it's fun.
That's it.
It's beautiful to be alive. It's beautiful to be breathing. It's beautiful to be loving. It's beautiful to have things to do to motivate and inspire others. It's beautiful to have life. It's beautiful to have love. It's beautiful to be you, because you are the best friend you're going to have. And that's why we're here. We're here to learn the truth of ourselves.
Right.
Accept it.
Right.
Love it. And when you know the truth of yourself, you can simply relax and know everything coming to you is their truth, and it's not to be judged or hampered or hit with a bat.
Now, have you always been your own best friend, or there's times I tend to be my worst enemy sometimes, too. So were you at one point like, hey, I'm my worst enemy,
right?
And now that you're doing better, it's like now I'm my best friend.
Well, what happens when you've had a traumatic brain injury like you and me?
Tricycle accident.
No, I got hit with a baseball. He might be right.
Huh.
No, that's what I am in the play.
What?
I'm a baseball bat killer.
What do you mean?
I'm an insane genius.
Oh, you kill people with a baseball bat?
No, that means I'm not acting. Everything's natural.
Oh, boy.
I'm an insane genius. And no, I don't use a baseball bat. I make mine look like accidents.
Oh.
So when you had your brain injury, how long did it take you to kind of use? I saw a documentary on that where guys, like some guys never get better. Yeah. And like what happened when you started getting better? What was it that first started to come back for you? Like when you started, your brain started to heal?
Well, I had to spend 2.5 months in Daniel Freeman Hospital, and I had to learn how to walk and talk and eat and dress myself. And a doctor said, Gary, tell us when you're ready to go home. And I said one time, I'm ready to go home. And they said, why? When I put my shoes under the bed, I can smell them. I said, great, Gary, keep working on it. I know I'm ready to go home now. Why is that? Well, because the hospital is at the end of the runways, and the jets won't land because they'll kill us. That's why all you hear is jets. Well, from 5 p.m. to 11 p.m., Daniel Freeman's right under the flight path of LAX, and that's all you heard were jets. And they said, Gary, keep working on it. But I got out 2.5 months early. I got out after 2.5 months, and I went home and started over again. Short-term memory I had a fight with. But all you people out there that are doing something that's concerning your computer, which sits on top of your neck, you must wear a helmet. You must wear a helmet when you're snow skiing, snowboarding, bicycling, rollerblading, skateboarding, motorcycles. And I even wear a helmet in the shower.
You just in case.
Just in case. You never know where you might slip on the soap.
And I get what you're saying about computer on your neck. You know what he's talking about, Jim?
No, I don't have a computer on my neck.
It's your brain.
Oh.
How do you like that?
I like it.
It's your brain.
It's not only your brain, but it's your five senses in your mind.
Did you lose any of your senses, or did any of them change?
No, they got more keen, more delicate.
Really?
More sensitive. Yeah, it's like, whoa. You go to the other side and come back, you know that there's so much strong life around you spiritually. And you don't have to be in a religion, but the spirituality is with you forever.
So you find you're more perceptive now.
Well, here's the deal. An organized religion, they are built for people to be afraid of hell.
Mm-hmm.
Spirituality is for people who have been there. I'm in the second group.
Did you see any white light or anything? Did you have any experience like that?
Did I have what?
Any like white light experience?
No white light experience. I was there and surrounded by balls that were about as big as volleyballs moving all around me, amber, magenta, white, gold. And I was about a foot and a half long and a quarter of an inch wide. And that's your soul. And your soul is housed in the column of your spine. Hey! I knew I could wake you up.
Travis wasn't paying attention, was he?
No, he wasn't.
And I heard column of my spine. And then
I was floating in spiritual space with these balls all around me. And three of them came up to me. The one on the left was Abalone, Mother of Pearl.
Right.
And that spoke to me in an androgynous voice, telling me where I was going and what I needed to do. And I could come with them now and return to my body.
Did it sound like that little guy, Skep, or whatever his name was?
No, it didn't sound like me.
Get away from here, Smack.
Who is Smack?
Smack. Not Smack.
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 Smack. Oh.
It's S-M-A-K. Smack.
Smack. Not Smack. Smack. I said it right.
Yeah, that's it. Smack.
Smack. Smack.
Yeah. Fucking smack. Yeah.
Do you like my pants?
Chip likes your
Fuck
pants.
Yeah.
Smack.
It's a garbage.
Oh, man. You guys... You guys are so funny with each other. You're not funny at all, but to each other,
no,
you're a
it's
scream.
Funny. Because Smack, when a Chip came,
Chip is a
and
character.
Then Smack left.
Yeah. Who's Chip?
Chip Chipperson.
Exactly.
He embodies,
who?
He takes over, Chip Chipperson takes over the body of
Chip
Jim Norton.
Chipperson.
The way Smack takes over the body of.
Chip Chipperson is not a legal name.
It is.
What's Lyle Chipperson?
It's very funny.
Oh, yeah. Who's Lyle?
Lyle Chip Chipperson. He is a person who sometimes takes over the body of Jim Norton.
Hey, I got news for you, Sam.
Tell me.
You got to find a different way to entertain yourself.
What do you mean?
I mean, figure out something smarter.
Yeah, please.
But I was there talking to Smack a minute ago.
That
What's
is
the
true.
Difference?
Well, Smack?
Yeah.
What's the difference with Smack and Chip?
Yeah, what's the difference?
No, they're two different identities.
I see.
Just like you and your buddy is.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Just like the cameraman over there.
That's D-Bag.
Yeah.
This man, who?
D-Bag.
D-Bag.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What's D stand for?
Douche.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He vomits a lot. He's a sick boy.
Man, you guys are hilarious.
He's a Thank you very boy. Much.
Dan, I'm going to stay here all day.
Yes. Yes. Please do. By the way, that's your son, Jake, behind
yes,
you, right?
Yes, this is Jake Busey behind me.
Let me tell you something. You know what's
this
a great
guy,
movie?
His first.
Identity. Oh, I love man. That movie, and you're very scary in that movie. Very intimidating. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
His first movie was when he was 5 years old. I was doing a picture with Dustin Hoffman called Straight Time, and I needed a son. And Dustin said, "What about Jake?" And we interviewed him and put him together. And he chose his own name. He wanted to be Henry. Mm-hmm. And he came out. He did every scene in one take because he said, "I'm only going to do this scene once because I'm drawing some trucks." And we went, "Oh, okay." And so we went through it. He did it perfect. On the way home, we're driving home, and I said, "Jake, you did a great job today. You did everything in one take. You chose your own name. What do you think acting? What do you think about acting now?" Mm-hmm. And he said, "I think it's the dumbest thing I've ever done."
He didn't like it.
I said, "Well, why did you think it's dumb? Everything was perfect on there. Why do you think it's dumb?" "Because all you do is pretend, except you play like you're not pretending. And I'd rather be drawing a truck."
Yeah, well, I get that.
When you're five, I can understand acting not being appealing.
I'm not sure that I sounded like that, though.
Yeah, it kind of sounded like smack.
Yeah, it sounded a little like smack.
No, it didn't sound like
anything. I don't know if it's a genetic thing or not or what, but no, I did think acting was kind of a silly endeavor at the time, and I do like the fact that he's coined that phrase, and it actually is one of those things that it makes me think, because after 25 years of doing this myself, it's like, yeah, you know, the reality of it is, yeah, you do pretend and you play like you're not pretending. And so to a kid, it's like,
brilliant.
No, if we're,
that's brilliant.
Mm-hmm. You know, we're playing cowboys and Indians. We're doing cowboys and Indians. Of course, I guess that's so politically incorrect. I'm probably going to get, don't tweet me, please.
Well, what did you want to do when you were five? What did you want
to
do?
You wanted to draw trucks. Like
when I was, yeah, I was busy drawing trucks.
Yeah.
You know, henceforth, I've gotten really into the whole desert racing thing out in California and Baja and all that. That's been one of my lifelong endeavors. But, you know, at the age of five, I was really into playing drums because he had his drum set in the living room, because he got his start in the entertainment industry by being a drummer in 1966 in a band that got a record deal.
That seems dangerous, though. Like, if you're racing now, knowing that your dad had the accident that he had.
Yeah, well, you know, I've always worn a helmet.
Right, that's the difference. That's, yeah, it's as simple as that, isn't it?
Yeah, and I got a cage around me. You know?
Right.
So,
do you ever worry about your son doing the moving quickly in vehicles?
No,
no.
This kid is great.
Yeah,
I helped him put an engine into a pickup truck, and he built things. I witnessed him building a truck when we lived in Malibu West. He did it all from scratch. And there's this kid is doing this and making a train track out of an end train, which is very small, and building a bridge out of matchsticks. Just detail, detail, detail. I just walk by and go, "Hey, that's good." I wasn't with my son as I should have been in my heart. But that's been changed.
Yeah, but you're here now.
Right.
I'm here now, yeah.
You're here now.
Hey, how does the rest of the cast of this play that is playing at the Times Square's Theater Center, it's called Perfect Crime, now through December 4th only. It's a very limited run where you can see Gary Busey. But how does the rest of the cast deal with you? Because, you know, I don't want you to take this the wrong way, but you're a bit of a handful.
Well, that's okay.
Yeah.
That does come with my dinner.
Right.
The situation is they're lovely. Everyone's lovely. And Catherine Russell, mm-hmm. who plays the lead, she is fantastic. She's got batteries in her that came from another dimension, because she doesn't quit. She teaches acting. She goes and does this. She auditions. Then she's back doing the play.
What made you do this one, like, as opposed to, I'm sure you've been offered other plays over the years. How come you haven't done them and you just wanted to do this one?
I was doing something else.
Oh. You always
other
busy.
Projects.
Yeah. Other projects.
The only reason I ask about the rest of the cast is I remember the only time I've seen you perform as part of a team is the two seasons of Celebrity Apprentice. And in those seasons, people got frustrated with you, if I remember correctly. That's what
people
it looked
got
like.
What?
Frustrated with you. I saw it on TV.
They weren't. You know what? You know what the truth is?
Tell me.
They were frustrated with themselves, and they were projecting their frustration with themselves onto me.
Huh.
And
yeah, because Mr. Trump took a very big shine to you.
Yeah.
He liked you.
Yeah. Now, Donald would write my name down at the top of the list when mm-hmm. it came to the Celebrity Apprentice.
Mm-hmm.
And Celebrity Apprentice All-Stars, I was on the team that won with Trace Adkins.
Right.
What did he like so much about you?
Who?
Trump. What do you think he liked about you so much?
I don't know. I don't know. He's right there in the boardroom. He'd call me a genius or a brilliant mind. Don't know where he's coming from. And there's a common thing between me and Donald, and it's just a frequency, you know, that we have together. And it works. It works great. And I'm very happy to have done that.
I got to tell you one of the most hilarious things that happened to me that last year, I have a daughter that's 4 years old, and we took her to a new preschool at last year.
So my granddaughter.
She would have been three. And you know, you're meeting the parents, the other kids, and I see these other two parents, and one of them is this tall, beautiful, blonde woman, and then her husband is this guy that's got a big, long, gray goatee and tattoos all over his arms, you know, and so she says to me, she goes, you're Jake, right? Your dad's Gary, right? And this is, of course, when Celebrity Apprentice is going on. And I said, yeah, my dad's Gary, and she said...
You say Gary?
Yeah, you. And
that is your name.
And she said, my dad's Meatloaf. And right there, I was like, that's cool. All right. You know, and we both had a big laugh because, you know, it was sort of like one of those moments of, oh, our crazy dad's fighting over a shopping basket with some paints, you know.
Yeah.
And there we were with our kids and they're playing together. So it was interesting.
What do you think is the biggest misinterpretation people have about your father?
I think the biggest misinterpretation, and I even get flack for it, like I'll my agent will tell me, yeah, the casting people don't want to see you because you're crazy. What do you mean I'm crazy? Well, they've seen your dad, but that's not me. And I think the misconception about him is that he's this crazy sort of volatile, wild, unpredictable person. I think
out of rhythm.
I think that one of the things that they don't understand is that he's probably one of the biggest hearted, kind hearted, most generous people. And extremely sensitive and extremely intuitive and probably one of the most brilliant people that I've ever met. And that's one thing that doesn't really go down.
So you think the reputation for being crazy is unfairly kind of surpassed the reputation of being a great actor and a good person?
Well, as Hillary Clinton said, there's a personal side and there's a public side. And right.
You think that's true, Gary? Are you that brilliant?
Let him finish.
Yep.
And, you know, my grandfather, his dad was a Navy CB, an engineer. He was an extremely bright man. He was an architect and on the genius level of IQ. And I think that there's a genetic thing, and Dad's not far off from that.
Yeah.
And yeah, he had a motorcycle accident, and that does make him a little short-tempered. And it does, you know, he needs a little
not anymore,
bit of,
not anymore, not anymore.
Sometimes you get angry, though?
No,
but I think it's a frustration. It's something
what?
That...
What?
Tell me about your neurofeedback.
What's the neurofeedback?
Yeah, neurofeedback.
Let's... Neurofeedback. I go see a girl named Shirley. Uh-huh. Stephanie and I do, and... she puts four little round things like batteries on your skull, and then you watch a video, and she has a machine watching your brain waves. And she is, it's like looking how your brain waves go and how you think, and I'm great. I'm even.
What?
She said it's correcting.
You got to get up here.
It's correcting your brain waves?
Yep. I don't know.
Yes.
And I think there's a combination,
yes.
too, that also is not really publicized, and that is Dad was, I think he really would have benefited, what really would have served him well is if he had started doing Broadway plays 30 years ago, because one thing that he thrives on is the interaction with other people.
Right. Yeah. Loves the audience.
And he loves the audience, and yet in the film industry, when you're working on a film, you've got like four people around the camera, you know, a couple actors, camera guy, director, and that's about it.
And you do a scene, they go, cut, it's in the can, okay, let's go on the other one.
And then it's quiet.
And there's none of this.
Yay!
And so
right,
he,
but you like that.
Right, he loves
it. Who doesn't?
It.
So
right,
he, sure.
I love it.
He spent
you've never heard it.
The better
that's
part
true.
Of the 80s.
Conceptually, I love it.
Exactly, right?
Okay.
So go he ahead. Spent the better part of the 80s in the 90s running around to local rock clubs playing music and really thriving on the crowd and the people and the interaction
yeah.
there. And had he just done Broadway 20 years ago, I mm-hmm. think it really would have served him well. So this... is going to be a fantastic endeavor, and that's why I came to see opening.
Would night. Broadway have been harder back then, though, if the the lifestyle wasn't as healthy as it is now? Would Broadway have been harder to do with the drinking and the drugs? And it might have been a harder thing to
it
memorize
might have been
the lines.
More fun.
It wasn't drinking, non-alcoholic.
Oh, okay.
My drug of choice was a C note.
Okay.
And I mean the $100 bill and what starts with C.
Sure.
And I OD'd on that May the 3rd, 1995, and couldn't figure out why I was doing that. I was dancing with the devil. And the situation is, when you dance with the devil, don't let him lead. You do the leading of the dancing. And the minute the song's over, maybe two beats before the song's over, remove yourself from the dancing ring with the devil.
Right. Makes sense.
And you said you're doing the thing with getting angry. Is it harder not to get angry with the brain injury? Does that cause you to fire off quickly? And
what?
Then...
What?
What?
Gary never gets angry. He's impulsive.
Impulsive, okay.
He has no problem with anger
so,
at all.
So how do you, like, control the impulsiveness? With
no,
what
it's easy. It's easy. Where I am now at 72 years old, going through what I've gone through, having this beautiful firstborn son, Jake, and having the new son, Luke, who's 6 years old, and having my daughter, Electra, I have a strong family around me with nothing but love. It's like living with angels. And the situation with losing my temper comes from anger. I'm going to take the letters to spell anger and give you abusism. A-N-G-E-R stands for
right.
Another negative grievance explaining rage.
That works.
It does.
That works entirely.
And the word hate, the word hate, H-A-T-E.
Yes, 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 please.
That stands for holding a treacherous energy.
Right, and I don't want to do that.
No,
nobody wants to do that. It's no good. Do you think a lot of people around here, they were talking about, they think that you're going to end up in the White House now because you and Trump have this relationship, that you're going to end up somewhere in the cabinet or doing something.
I won't end up there, but I'll be going there. I'll be going there. I'm gonna work on a dance contest between Pence and Trump, and Condoleezza Rice, and maybe who's that other girl? No, she's not there anymore, so we won't mention that. I'm not going to do a dance contest. I'm just going to say hello to a good friend of mine. I'm so proud of him for doing what he did.
Yeah.
Were you surprised he won or no?
Wait a minute. I'm so proud of him for doing what he is.
Were you surprised he won, or because you know him, you aren't surprised?
I knew he was going to win in the beginning.
You did.
And we're watching, Stephanie and I were watching the elections that night on TV.
Yeah.
Went to sleep, turned it off, and I got up in the morning about 5 a.m., and she said,
Hello?
Mm-hmm. You're not going to say what she said?
I don't like when people quote me.
Oh. Okay, I can't say anymore.
Can
I'm
you
just
paraphrase?
With everything, huh?
Can you paraphrase?
Nah.
Can I what?
A paraphrase. She didn't want to be quoted, so I was like, maybe you could paraphrase. Okay,
right.
Directly.
So another great thing that people don't know about is that the Buseyisms actually came out of the brain injury. Part of his healing was putting words together and learning how to speak. My mother and I had to teach him how to speak and how to eat and how to walk, and he was, you know, pretty much, you know, comatose in a wheelchair. So when he was learning how to talk, he was, like he said, he was due to be released out of the hospital because he said, my shoes are under the bed and something I can smell.
Nice.
So that type of thing, was sort of spurned the whole Buseyism thing, which was him trying to put meaning on things and understand the language.
My first Buseyism was I was writing in a book, and it was all about the past. It was about being betrayed. It's like, why this, why that? And I realized, man, you're talking about the past. Where are you? I'm in the now. Now, okay? And now it came to me. Now stands for no other way.
Boom. Because you got no choice.
When you're in the now, you see, the past is history. The future is a mystery. And being in the now is a present because they call it the presence.
We have to wrap you up and let you go to your next interview.
No, I'm not done.
Yeah, we're not trying to. They're telling us.
And by the way,
you stay as long as you want.
I did like witnessing what we saw a moment ago, which was what he said at the beginning of the interview, agreeing with the wife.
Yes.
I noticed.
Quite shocking, wasn't it?
Yeah.
It was amazing. She stopped Gary in his tracks. I didn't think that was possible.
Nope. And Gary was like, all right, then it's a no.
She made the zip it sign and Gary zipped it.
Oh,
smart man.
He did.
Smart man.
Yeah, he did.
You know, when she starts talking, my brain freezes.
Is that right?
Okay. It's been good being here.
Gary, everybody can see Perfect Crime now through December 4th at Times Square's Theater Center. You can go to perfect-crime.com, get tickets. It's right in the middle of Times Square. It's across the street from, like, it's right by Caroline's.
I would like to go see this.
Yeah.
You know, you need... You know, you need to, because that was...
Just yell.
That was Smack running out the door with a burnt butt.
Oh.
You need to go see it because I'm here for 2 weeks.
Right. See it immediately. Don't hesitate. It's going to sell out. He's only going to be here for 2 weeks. And who knows? Maybe Smack will show up in the middle of the play.
Yeah, I'll be there.
Thank you, Gary Busey.
Thank you.
And we'll be back with more Jim Norton and Sam Roberts after this. That's a good addition.
Thank you.
Welcome back. It's Jim Norton and Sam Roberts.
That was very, very fun.
Travis, did you enjoy Gary Busey?
So much.
I didn't know Jake Busey was coming with him. I just saw him. I was like, that's that motherfucker from that movie, Identity.
Yeah.
And then I didn't know if it was his brother or his son. That's his son. It's his kid.
We had a nice chat with Gary after, too. We didn't want to wrap him up, but they were saying he had other stuff. But he stayed for a few minutes and just... He had a great time.
Yeah.
He was really, really great.
It was so funny. Spencer was a little worried that he was going to... I go, is he doing other shows after us? And he said, yeah. That's why he has to leave. But he goes, well, I mean, he's planning to. I don't know, because he was worried that Gary was going to walk out. Because he's heard that Gary has walked out on interviews because of politics.
Right.
He's a weird guy. You could see that guy
sure.
finding a random reason to walk out of an interview. But, yeah, I mean, after when we were here, he gave us a big group hug.
Yeah.
And kept making jokes, and then he said that he had a very, very good time.
Yeah, he's like, you guys are so fast. It was really fun, man.
You're fast, and you're quick.
Yeah. And he likes my stand-up. I think that's what's important.
I don't know if that even affected me.
But to me, he did make a nice comment.
I didn't notice it at all, to tell you the truth.
Yeah. A lovely comment.
I did already know where the soul was located, because he told us that the last time we spoke to him.
I did not remember that.
Yeah.
I can't believe he remembered sperm farmer on my shirt.
Right.
Jesus Christ.
Right.
Weird. Like, I guess a brain injury makes your mind, like he said, short term, but maybe with other stuff it highlights it better.
It almost, like, yeah, like it shuts down certain functions and activates others, maybe. I don't know. The brain is a weird thing. I don't believe that any of these doctors or scientists have really even come close to figuring out.
But that fucking, the guy we just sat with,
yeah,
like very unpredictable, mm-hmm. and he seems to have a good memory. So watching him live in a play, it must be a very alive feeling. Like,
oh, yeah.
Because he seems to be really in the fucking moment.
Well, yeah, because he's like, he's great with awareness and memory and all that stuff. But his instinct seems to be on a hairline trigger. Like when you talk about a guy who is running off of his instincts,
yeah.
I would say that he probably adds a lot to a live element.
And he, we took a photo with him, and afterwards, it was actually Gary's idea. He's like, let's take a picture. And
yeah.
He tickled us.
He did. He grabbed us by the side and started tickling. Jim was like, stop it. No, no, Gary.
I was giggling. Yeah. I was giggling.
It was fun.
I'm very ticklish.
I'm glad we had him in.
He did that years ago, too. I totally forgot.
Yeah.
I met him years ago when I opened for Dice and Rascals in New Jersey in West Orange, and Gary Busey was at the show.
I think he did it to his last time, because if I remember...
Did he? I don't remember.
The only other time he's been in here, he was doing the after show, and you stuck around.
That's right.
To do it with me.
That's right.
And we had fun with him then, but he talked about Trump. He talked about everything. You know, he was very good.
Yeah, well, he was going to say something. His wife stopped him. I guess she's also got to make sure he doesn't fucking totally fucking sink the whole ship.
Well, it seemed like he was going to say something that she said.
Yes.
And maybe, like, she's a big Hillary person or something, and she didn't need him announcing that to the world, and they have an awkward dinner at the White House or something.
Maybe, yeah.
Well, isn't that great, though? I believe that Donald Trump will invite Gary Busey to the White House for dinner. Just imagine, like, Gary Busey gets to sit down and have dinner with the president. That's fucking awesome.
Yeah, they're friends.
Like, that's hilarious.
Everyone likes Gary Busey.
He's the man.
I didn't bring up Carney. You know, it's my favorite. I forgot he was in Straw Dogs. Jesus Christ, I forgot about that.
By the way, people can see a bunch of the Gary Busey interview. Obviously, we're going to edit it and put it on the YouTube channel.
Sure.
But if you want to see quick highlights of it, and some of the stuff that happened during the break, right?
Yes.
Our Snapchat's always being updated. So if you go to Sam and Jim, or Jim and Sam Show, Jim and Sam Show on Snapchat, you can see all the stuff that was happening during the show.
Well, there's nothing totally private. Oh, no, it's just us taking a picture.
Yeah, stuff that, like the fun stuff that was happening during the breaks, the tickling, all that stuff.
Do you save those? I would love to have that.
Yeah.
I would love to see that. That's funny.
Yeah, because, you know, save all the video, and maybe on Fridays we'll put together some kind of, like, Snapchat best, recap for YouTube.
How about we call it, like, best of the Snapchat Sam, Jim and Sam moments from the week.
How about this?
Best of Snapchat.
Jim and Sam's snapshot.
Stinks. How about
okay, well, Adrian liked it.
The best Snapchatting moments between now and last week from Jim and Sam?
That's actually a little better. I see where that does have a little more marketability behind it. Plus, it's clickable. You know what I mean? It's very clickable.
That sounds a little clickbaity.
Speaking of brains, man, I will tell you, and I hate to bring up Survivor Series again from last night, but your buddy Shane McMahon, you performed at his bachelor party
yes,
and everything.
I did.
He got a hell of a concussion last night.
Wouldn't know. I didn't watch it.
Holy shit. He didn't have a fucking clue where he was at one point. Like he had to be carted out of there. It was scary.
Oh well, good luck, Shane.
You don't care that he got concussed.
Nope.
And had no idea where he was.
Nope.
Brain injury. Why do you not care? Shane McMahon hurt himself, and you don't care.
No.
Why?
Just don't.
But he could have done real damage. Doesn't bother you one way or the other.
Nope.
No. Okay. It's very cold of you, don't you think?
Nope.
You perform comedy at his bachelor party?
Oh, yeah. Shane. Oh, I hope he's okay.
Yeah. Yeah, he just, he smashed his head as he was landing. And like, they were trying to talk to him, like, to give him his assignments in the match so he could do what he was supposed to do.
Yes.
And he was fucking not there. He was gone.
Well, you know, he'll be okay.
You think so?
Yes.
You're kind of a medical expert. Adrian, yeah. you'll see his face after he lands. He's on La La La. Look at him.
Yeah. Is he genuinely hurt? For real?
Oh, yeah. He got a real concussion.
All right.
Yeah, look at his eyes. He's not blinking. They're trying to talk to him.
Can I see that again?
Yeah, look at him. First of all, he's a fucking maniac. Ugh.
Oh, boy.
Look at the way his hand just kind of limps up like that.
Yep. Did the guy know he was hurt?
Roman, yeah. I mean, I think I
just look at his eyes.
You can totally tell immediately. Yeah, he's not blinking. He's not responding. He's just trying to. He's like a newborn baby right now.
Yay!
Just trying to figure everything out. They helped him out, like he could stand up after, and they walked him out. But it was fucking scary for a second.
Wow. That's crazy. What are you doing with that kind of money?
I know.
Just be the nerd who doesn't do it.
Look at him. He doesn't have to do this. He does, and he's out of the business. He's got his own businesses. Did you just toot because you were afraid for Shane? Did you just get scared for Shane so you tooted?
Tinking and tooting all day. That's what I did.
Did a toot come out because you were afraid for your friend?
You don't like it?
It's great.
Okay.
yeah. Terrific.
Don't be uncomfortable.
Terrific. Keep it up.
Yeah. Ow, tink and toot, Batman.
What is that?
Tomorrow,
it's the new Joker. You didn't like it?
Cartoon Joker.
It's good. What?
It's so uncomfortable.
It's so bad. It stinks like poop, and then you do the Joker sound. It
makes me feel dirty.
The Joker let off laughing gas, I guess.
There you go. You don't like to laugh.
It's so dumb.
I disagree. I think it's a hit.
No,
I think
it isn't.
Travis loves it.
It's terrible.
It's terrible, right?
I'm so glad it's a short week.
I know.
I forgot it was a short week.
It is. It's Thanksgiving this week.
It's true.
Are you coming over
today through Thursday?
Are you coming over for Thanksgiving?
I am, actually.
To my house?
No.
Why?
Why would I?
You were invited.
Oh, I'm busy. No, I might.
Doing what?
I might, actually.
You should. Tomorrow, it's going to be a fun show. Scheduled to be here. Did we find out the timing? Is that all being worked out? Oh, well, he's on West Coast. Roland's helping us out, but he's in Vegas.
Roland!
So he's on... By the way, you talk about a fucking no-sell job. Way to make Chip relate to Gary Busey's character. Gary Busey just would not give you the time of day when you started whipping out Chip.
Well, he didn't... I don't think he really understood what Chip was.
We explained it to him.
Yeah, he got it.
Yeah, it's...
And then he was like, yeah, I'm not fucking playing character for character with you. Gave you the big no-sell on it.
I love that not even Gary Busey will interact with Chip.
No, he thinks it's stupid.
Yeah, you're right. You're probably right.
That sounds stupid to me.
Yeah, you're not wrong.
We have...
Very fun time with him, though. I really want to see this play. Because, you know, it's like people do forget, the guy's a fucking tremendous actor. Like, he's not just this goofy guy who had an accident. He's a brilliant actor. I really, really want to see this.
Well, tomorrow, the boys from Legion of Skanks are coming in.
Yes.
All three of them
are
going to be here. It's like Flintstones meet the Jetsons, but with cursing.
No, I don't think it's like that.
You don't think so?
No.
At all?
No, the douchebags meet the cunts. That's fair enough.
Who do we get to be?
Either one.
Okay, cool.
That's up for interpretation. I'll let the Legion guys choose.
Cool. That's really good of you.
Don't forget, Ben Bailey has a special now, therealbenbailey.com, our pal. You can pick it up. And also, Gary promoted Perfect Crime, now through only December 4th at Times Square's Theater Center. It's perfect-crime.com.
Yeah, and check out our YouTube channel, youtube.com/Jim and Sam Show. We were uploading over the weekend. I think the newest video is Colin watching Scorch's acting reel with us, which, again, Scorch, it's just not going to win me any favor with Scorch.
Yo, baby, but maybe we could go see Gary together.
I mean, I'll see Gary with you, but don't do the voice.
You want to go on a date and shit?
No. No, it's not a date.
Come on, Ma.
I'm a man.
Let me take you out, Ma.
No.
So take you to see Gary Busey and shit.
I've never met anybody that, like, is going for silence as the reaction.
You know how hard it is for me not to say something right now?
Well, then I guess we'll end the show.
It was fun today.
Yeah, it was really fun. And it'll be fun tomorrow, too.
Well, let's hope.
We'll see you then.
Yes,
God
we will.
Willing.
God willing. God boy, Sam.
Should we make it till tomorrow?
Yep.
Don't you fucking hate it when those talk show hosts?
Never assume.
Should we make it to tomorrow? We'll see you then.